19th, 2019 Prince George's County Board of Education meeting. Highlights this evening will include the news break entitled Writing Royalty. Please continue to check www.pgcps.org for upcoming Board of Education meetings and events. And now, the September 19th, 2019 Board of Education meeting will begin.
Thank you, Ms. Rowe. And before we begin our meeting this evening, I would ask everyone to please turn off any wireless communication devices as they may interfere with the microphones and the taping of our meeting. At this point, Ms. Williams, would you please lead us in the Board's prayer and the Pledge of Allegiance? Thank you, Ms. Williams. Ms. Tate, would you now call the roll?
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Ms. Ahmed?
Here.
Ms. Boozer Strother?
Here.
Mr. Burroughs?
Here.
Ms. Eubanks?
Here.
Mr. Montero?
Here.
Mr. Murray?
Here.
Mr. Omolola?
Here.
Ms. Queen, Ms. Shepherd,
here.
Mr. Thomas,
here.
Mr. Valentine,
here.
Mr. Watt,
present.
Ms. Williams,
present.
Dr. Thornton,
present. Thank you, and let me take the opportunity to, as always, thank Ms. King, you and your staff, for preparing for tonight's board meeting. Ms. Tate, thank you very much, and. I want to recognize again, because he's new to us, his second meeting, Mr. Thomas, our board counsel. Welcome again, sir, and thank you. Colleagues, at our last meeting, you'll recall that we passed a resolution recognizing the life, the unique life and legacy of one of America's greatest daughters, Toni Morrison. And we didn't give very much attention to that resolution passed by this Board of Education. But I wanted, and my board colleagues, I'm sure, wants the community to understand the significance of the board's passage of that resolution. Even though not a daughter of our school system, she is one of America's greatest daughters, one of America's greatest literary scholars, the world's literary scholars. So we wanted to signal our support of her life and her legacy, and indicate the significance of writing in our school system. And Dr. Golson, the work of you and your staff with our Writing Royalty Initiative. And we connected those two things because the most important skill set that our children can have, as you know, is the ability to write and communicate and to read. And that's what Toni Morrison represents. So that's what your board did unanimously in passing that resolution, recognizing this great daughter that helped America through some of its most difficult times during the Jim Crow period of discrimination. And she wrote and gave identity to the lives of African Americans, particularly those who were most oppressed. And so I want to thank my board colleagues for unanimously approving that resolution. I want to ask, if I could, at this point, for a moment of silence for members of our family who are no longer with us. Ms. Yvette Blount, a food service assistant at the Valley View Elementary School, and mother of Marlo Blount Rich, principal of the District Heights Elementary School. Giselle Mitchell Howard, a sister of Darlene Mitchell Howes, Budget Management Services, and Mr. Ralph Peters, Northwestern High School Guidance Counselor. And significantly, the passing of one of our own board colleagues, Ms. Barbara Martin, who was 97 years old, a former member of the Prince George's County Board of Education, one of the great daughters, a student of the mother of education in Prince George's County, Teresa Banks. Her husband, Clem, worked in the school system for almost 50-some-odd years, just a great daughter, and she passed and was funeralized on yesterday. A moment of silence, please, for each of those individuals. Thank you very much. Upcoming meetings, tonight's meeting, obviously, on the 19th. Our next meeting will be meeting announcements, Board of Education, we've already had. Academic Achievement Committee meeting on September 24th. You'll see the board's work to the community is organized around three major committees. We want the community to become aware of those committees. Academic Achievement, chaired by Mr. Montero, Government and Policy, chaired by Ms. Ahmed, and our Budget Operation and Physical Affairs, chaired by Mr. Wallace. So the Academic Achievement Committee will meet on the 24th at 5:30. There'll be a board meeting on the 10th of October, and then a board meeting on October the 24th. And there will also be meetings of the Board of Education, obviously available to you on the website, and you may access it there. Before I go to the Chief Executive Officer's report, I've been reminded that I was remiss in not adopting the agenda, so I'll call for a motion for that purpose.
So moved.
Those in any discussions of the agenda? Hearing none, those in favor, please say aye. Those opposing, no, the ayes have it. I would also ask for a motion regarding the minutes of our last board meeting.
So moved.
It's been properly moved and seconded that the minutes of our last board meeting be adopted. Those in favor, please say aye. And those opposing, no. And we'll now turn to our news break.
Ladies, you look so nice. Come on over and shake your hand.
While not all 199 of the exuberant young authors receiving medals at a recent ceremony were dressed like princesses, there were enough of them wearing tiaras and boys wearing bespoke suits that you had to believe you were watching writing royalty. And in a sense, you were. For in the packed auditorium at Eleanor Roosevelt High School, the County School's Office of Library Media Services was holding its 42nd annual Write a Book Awards that honored winning wordsmiths who were all bursting with pride and smiling broadly with anticipation.
Are you best friends?
Yes.
You guys are smiling as much as anybody can smile. Congratulations to all of you. Nice job.
Nonfiction's a real favorite. Family activities, they love to write about what I did over the summer or what I'm building at home. They especially like to write about their little sisters or brothers. It's kind of crazy. So, but you can tell they're taking, like we're trying to encourage them in the curriculum is to engage in the real world. Write a book really brings that out in them.
With their book covers writ large on a screen, the winners out of 495 entries in categories like short stories, plays, graphic fiction, and poetry, cross the stage, had medals draped around their necks, and then posed for photos for their beaming parents. For some of the young authors, winning a medal or two was both unexpected and deeply emotional.
Is this the first time you've won?
Yes.
Wow. How does that feel?
I remember when I got the paper and that I saw like it was first place, I broke down in tears because I didn't really expect to have won. Some people even told me that like there was a big chance I wasn't going to win.
I was really excited. I didn't cry, but like I was still excited. This is my first time winning too, and I appreciate it.
For fourth grader Julianne Calloway, whose book chronicled her visits to New York carousels on her grandmother's bucket list, writing is something she's long embraced.
The best part of the trip was not going on the carousels or being in New York, but spending time with my family. The best part was spending time with my family because I got to spend time with my grandmother, who lives 4 hours away in New Jersey. In first grade, I wrote a book and entered it and in second grade I won first place. Last year I didn't place, but I still wrote a book, and this year I wrote this. And currently at my house I'm writing other books, like a zombie apocalypse book. I'm really into science fiction and stuff.
And while some of the titles reflected the write-a-book author's serious sides, like The Facts on World War I, The Broken Promises about Depression, and one that sounded familiar, Mama Said There Would Be Days Like This, almost all pointed to, if not a happy ending, then stories that would likely continue.
And would you like to continue writing? Because if you're a good writer, which you obviously are, it's something that makes people happy because they can read your emotions and your words. Do you want to keep writing?
Most definitely, yes. Yeah.
Congratulations to all the celebrated young writers as they move on to the next chapter in their literary lives. This is Dave Zarin reporting.
That's what Toni Morrison would be proud of. And at this point, colleagues, I would like to recognize Ms. Williams for a point of personal privilege. Ms. Williams.
Thank you, Chair. It is such an honor to serve the community in all my roles, both past and present. And it's very pleasing when those roles intersect. Earlier today, in my role on the MedStar Southern Maryland Hospital Board, I was introduced to the class of 2019 candy stripers that serve the hospital. What was really pleasing is that there were a lot of Prince George's County Public School students in that class, and they included Wise, Friendly, Oxon Hill, and the Academy of Health Science. Relationships like this helps us to showcase our amazing students, and it helps our students be ready for careers in the medicine field. I look forward to meeting the other students that are in those roles, and I look forward to seeing how the students that are currently in those roles will do in their future. There are a lot of them that plan to be pediatricians, nurse practitioners, X-ray technicians, physician's assistants, and the like. So our students are not only given opportunities here in our school to learn and participate in classes that help them with the future, but they also have the opportunity to practice those in real life. So I just want to congratulate all of those students, and I've shared it with our public affairs people, and hopefully we can get that out and celebrate them even more. I'm going to take an opportunity to talk about one more thing that is very important. Today, our very own Dr. Monica Golson was named one of the Washingtonians' Women That Mean Business. Congratulations, Dr. Golson.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Williams. And thank you, Dr. Golson. We're very proud of you. At this point, I would now turn the floor over to Dr. Golson for her report.
Thank you. Good evening. It's hard to believe that we are already in the third week of school. We're off to a great start, although we continue to face on-time arrival issues with transportation for a few bus routes. But we remain committed and focused on providing students with the best service and support they need to succeed in school, and ask for your continued partnership in this endeavor. During the month of September, I encourage you to take part in your child's back to school night and to remain engaged throughout the school year. Involvement in education is key to your child's success. Parents and guardians of elementary school students should check their child's backpack daily for homework assignments and messages from school. Secondary students may need to be reminded to make time every day for homework. Referring often to the class outline or course syllabus helps students to plan ahead, keep up with reading, and stay on top of important deadlines, tasks, and tests. Monitor your child's academic progress online through SchoolMax, so if grades become an issue, they can be addressed well before the end of the grading period. Even though there are secondary students, parents, you may still need to go through their backpack to find important information that has not been shared by your child. Remember, you do still own that backpack. Please know that if you have any concerns, you can request a parent-teacher conference at any time. September is also Attendance Awareness Month, and improving attendance is one of our top priorities. We have updated our attendance policy and have provided families with tips for improving attendance. To kick off Attendance Awareness Month, students and staff show their commitment to attend school every day through our social media campaign, It's Not In to Be Out of School. This message was posted on school marquees, students shared selfies pledges through their commitment, and some schools hosted special attendance events. Please visit our attendance webpage for details. The first cohort of students in our new Career and Technical Education Evening High School at Bladensburg started Monday. 22 students are receiving innovative approach to learning and are provided the opportunity to learn and earn their high school diploma and industry certifications in the evening while being employed during the day in the career field related to their chosen program of study. The two programs of study are ProStart, which is a culinary arts program, and nursing. I am also pleased to announce that the Maryland Department of Environment has selected Prince George's County Public Schools to receive funds for electric school buses and chargers. More details about this exciting new green initiative will be shared soon. And then lastly, if you'd like to share your ideas for the school year and enjoy a cup of coffee, come to one of my Fall Mornings with Monica events. The first event will be held on this Monday, September 23rd at Starbucks and Brandywine Crossing from 8:30 a.m. to 10 a.m. If you're a business owner, interfaith leader, or representative from a nonprofit or community agency, or want to support Prince George's County Public Schools, join us, visit our website, or contact our community partnerships office. And lastly, I'd just like to say thank you to the Board of Education and for the Prince George's County Public School community for allowing me to represent them. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Golson. At this point, colleagues, we have 13 of our citizens who have registered to speak before the board. I would ask those individuals who are speaking before us to please adhere to the stipulations that were given to you as you signed up. The first individual to speak is Ms. Michelle Clark. Ms. Clark.
Oh, there we go. Good evening. As Dr. Golson already mentioned in her remarks, one of the problems that we are continuing to face as teachers is also the late buses. Being a teacher in an early childhood center with four-year-olds, it's extremely difficult when we have students who are stuck at school who are supposed to leave at 3:30 until times like 5:30, the following day 4:30 again, 4:20, 5:20 this Monday, 4:30, and 4:15 is the earliest we've gotten all of our buses in since school started. Mind you, the students are supposed to leave at 3:30. I'm supposed to leave at 4:00. On the days when I don't have meetings after school, I'm there every day with my students. Our administrator is appreciative. It doesn't solve the problem of having supervision for our youngest students to keep them safe in our building. And we are responsible for them for as long as they are in that building. I know I could get up and leave at 4:00 if I so chose and try and make an administrator stay with my students. I have a deep sense of responsibility to my students. I tell the parents when they come to me every year, your students are now my students. I will treat them like they are my own children because they're young children and that's the nurturing they need. At the same time, when we're supposed to be getting on the bus at 3:30 and kids are still there until 5:30, it's a bit difficult to entertain them for an additional 2 hours. They don't have the attention span. It's not their fault. But to make it even more difficult for us to get started is we also have buses arriving late. The children are supposed to be there at 9:30. We have some students who aren't getting there until 10 or 10:30. The whole point of pre-K is to get them ready for kindergarten. If they're not there for instruction, I can't get them ready. If they're there until they're so tired and cranky that they have no desire to be there, they're not wanting to be in school. I'm glad that you're aware of this issue, and I would request that you please continue to work on that, especially for our youngest students and our students with special needs. The 520 bus was actually our pre-K students without special needs, our typical peers. It really is an issue. Parents are concerned. We call them and let them know. But how can you explain 5 o'clock to come and pick up your child when they were out of school at 3:30?
Thank you, Ms. Clark, for your comments. The next speaker is Gregory Simmons. Mr. Simmons, please come forward.
Thank you, and good evening.
Good evening, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Thornton, and fellow board members, and Dr. Goldson, for providing the chance to speak tonight. My name is Gregory Simmons. I have 4 children, 3 of whom are at the elementary level, and 1 who soon will be, all in the Eleanor Roosevelt cluster. I'm also joined tonight by Deepa James, who's in the back, who is a representative of the Eleanor Roosevelt High School PTSA. I'm here tonight to call to the board's attention and PGCPS administration's attention to the Baltimore-Washington Superconducting Maglev Project. This is a 300-mile-an-hour magnetic levitation train project that currently is planned to go beneath 2 high schools and beneath, or very near, 5 other schools in the PGCPS system. I'd like to thank you, Mrs. Eubanks, and Mr. Thomas for responding to my emails last month about this issue. I've had some further conversations in the community. It's a project of growing concern. However, there may be a disconnect over who should spearhead the issue for the schools. I have 2 requests. First, to the extent it has not done so already, the board should formally direct the PGCPS administration and its Office of General Counsel to undertake a review of the Maglev project and its effect on PGCPS schools, so it can be prepared for the federally mandated draft environmental impact statement, which is expected later in this school year. Second, I ask that the board hold a publicly noticed meeting in the near future to update parents and educators on its plan to prepare for the DEIS. As you may be aware, major federal projects such as the Maglev project must adhere to the process laid out in the National Environmental Policy Act. For these large projects, NEPA requires a draft environmental impact statement to be developed. This is arguably the most important document in the official record before the federal government releases its final decision, and they are large and complicated. From the PGCPS standpoint, there are 2 important points that are prompting action. First, schools will be impacted. Eleanor Roosevelt High School, Bladensburg High School, Lamont Elementary School, and Beacon Heights Elementary School all have at least 1 alternative path underneath their school footprints. Charles Carroll Middle, Robert Frost Elementary, and Margaret Brent Special are less than 1/4 mile from an alternative path. Secondly, timing. Project developers have indicated the DEIS will be released in either Q4 this year or Q1 next year, and the comment period will likely be only 45 days. In closing, Prince George's County Public Schools has made significant strides to ensure we are investing in students' education. If PGCPS does not take this project seriously and attend to it, the project has the potential to physically damage schools and disrupt education long into the future. Please make sure our efforts to invest in our children is not undermined by this project. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Simmons. Our next speaker is Paul Moraine. Mr. Moraine, if you'll come forward. This is Paul.
Yes, hi, actually it's Paula.
Okay, it says Paul here, but so I apologize.
That's okay. I'm here, thank you so much for allowing me to speak this evening. I'm here, I'm a parent that actually had a case I think that you all deliberated on not too long ago. I'm a parent that actually requested a transfer for my particular student due to the fact that I was very unhappy and dissatisfied with the the school that she attends and how things were going there. I was concerned because she's actually an honor student and a TAG student, and I felt that her needs weren't being met. With that being said, I'm here today because I want to just kind of express to the board that, you know, as parents, we all talk to each other. We share information. We kind of go back and forth regarding how schools are doing and how our children are doing. And I just want to just express that there are several resources that we use to try to kind of gauge how our schools are doing. There's NISH.com, there's SchoolDigger.com, and there's GreatSchools.com. And I don't know if this is something that's been talked about, but as a parent, this is pretty much what I have to kind of gauge how things are going. I'm not sure if you know that, but as of now, NISH.com ranks Prince George's County Schools. They give it a 15. They rank them 15 out of 100. There's 15 schools, I'm sorry, with a B rating out of 143 schools. That's from NISH.com. From greatschools.com, they actually have one school, one elementary school that I'm looking at. That's the grade that my daughter attends, that has a 10 out of 10 ranking, one. And then the rest, only about six schools receive a 9 out of 10. The rest of the 155 that they've ranked are below a B ranking, or a 9 or a ranking out of 10. I'm presenting this information because I'm here to kind of pose a question. Two questions. My first question is, you know, regarding these external, outward resources that parents have, are there any plans to try to improve the reputation and the perception of Prince George's County Schools? That's number one. And number two, I'm also here to pose the question, what recommendation and advice would you give me as a parent who has expressed her frustration with how things are going with the particular school that my daughter goes to? She's kind of bound to this school due to the boundary that I'm living in. I did try to get her transferred. I put her in the lottery, and she's still there. So my question is, you know, as a parent for my child, but knowing that there are other parents out there who are also as frustrated, what would you recommend for us? Because really, at this particular time, our only other alternatives are private schools that we'd have to actually pay for. So I just wanted to use this forum to kind of vent and express the concerns and questions that are actually being discussed amongst ourselves, amongst my peers and colleagues. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Moraine, for your comments. The next speaker is Gordon Gaynor.
Good evening. I'm Dr. Gaynor, one of our teachers. I will point out two regulation errors that seriously harm our student culture. The administrative procedure on cell phones says, in limited urgent circumstances requiring immediate action, the school principal designee may confiscate a PED cell phone if he/she reasonably believes that confiscation is necessary to help protect the health, safety, or welfare of students or staff. In other words, principals can only rarely confiscate cell phones. We need a much tougher cell phone policy like the surrounding school districts. Across the county, we have rampant cell phone abuse. It is so common that many students feel it is acceptable to play on a cell phone off task instead of participating in class. This is insidious racism. Teachers call parents about cell phone abuse, but this rarely helps. Parents, if you protest and say, our children are not learning when they're idly playing on cell phones, then we will have a tougher cell phone policy. When well-behaved children see other children playing on cell phones, then they also do it. If the politicians only hear parents say, how dare you confiscate my child's cell phone, then we will continue with this harmful regulation. In the past, when parents sued because the school confiscated a child's cell phone until a parent picked it up, the school won in court, as long as the school previously gave parents notice of the strict cell phone policy. Board members and executives, it is difficult for you to see a real middle or high school. When you visit a school, you see a show. But if you quickly walk down hallways, look in door windows, or walk in many classrooms, you will see many students idly playing on cell phones. If you give an anonymous survey to teachers and students, you will see that we have a major cell phone problem. If you toughen up this regulation, you will see major improvements in students' knowledge, skills, and abilities. We also have a serious error in the grading regulation. It says that if students choose not to complete a science fair project, the teacher will provide an alternative assessment. This decimated our science fairs, since most students chose alternative assessments over the science fair project. As a result, students did not develop as much. I urge you to correct these harmful regulation errors. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Our next speaker is Latasha Frank Harrison.
Good evening. Thank you to the board for allowing me to speak this evening. I am here to be a voice for my daughter, Jewel Harrison, who attends Phyllis E. Williams Elementary School. This is an elementary school in Prince George's County that hosts the Spanish Immersion Program. I am here to share how passionate she is to wake up every day, to come to school, to learn about her teacher who's from Spain, and learn about the culture of Spain and Honduras and Mexico. And me as her parent, I am also here to be a voice for other parents that are not able to be here today to express their enthusiasm for their children to be in this program. But I also must share my frustration in my child being in this program. Because as being her parent, and each of you here being a representative, an advocate in education, we are gardeners for our children. And my daughter is a flower in that garden, and that garden represents a village. And our children in our village, I'm here to advocate for additional resources. One of the things that frustrates me currently about the school system in which my daughter resides in is the technological advancements that's available to my daughter. Our children are growing and learning at an accelerated rate, and technology is the key in the doorway that I feel to help accelerate and grow that knowledge and that presentation of that education presented to our children. So you may ask, how do we do this? I feel as though as a garden, in order for us to provide the proper nutrients, that we must look at areas in which we can incorporate new technology into our school to help our children to grow and embrace the education that's being presented to them in various formats. I am also advocating for technological advancements that can help expose our children and introduce our children to other children in other cultures around the world. Thank you for listening to me this evening. My name is Latosha Frank Harrison, and I am here on behalf of Joe Harrison.
Thank you, Ms. Harrison. The next speaker is Aletta Davidson. If you'll come forward, please.
Good evening, board.
Good evening.
I am Aletta Davidson, and this is my 10th year as a professional school counselor at Francis Fuchs Early Childhood Center. I come today with the blessing of my administration and my entire staff. We have some serious issues, serious concerns. One of the first concerns is our parent parking situation. I don't know how many of you know, but we have four shifts of arrival and departures. We have typical peers that come from the neighborhood. We have 500, 600 students in any given year. During our arrival in the morning, we have traffic jams that you would not believe. I sent pictures, and I'm going to leave pictures to the testimony email of exactly what I'm speaking to, so that you have those pictures to look at. Someone is going to get hurt outside. We have cars that have to double park. They're running children in. We have children with developmental delays that have mobility challenges, who are going through the parking lot with cars going every which way. We're having to put two staff members out in the parking lot to try and help the traffic situation. There's a lot going on at Francis Fuchs. I don't know if I can get to it all in 3 minutes, but I wanted to target that as a very big area of concern and need. My administrator is very overwhelmed and frustrated. She's tried to get that taken care of, and we really need some help. Second thing I want to talk about is well, let me tell you this first. So there's 60 to 70 parents dropping off children at any one time, okay? And the parent parking lot holds 35. Okay, so what do you do with the rest of the cars? We don't know. Staff parking. We have 148 staff members. We have approximately 52 marked spots for cars, and they're not well marked. We need new markings. Our building person has put in, building supervisor has put in repeatedly for repairs. They're not being done. We have parking areas that are not paved, where there are rocks, where when the weather is bad, it gets slippery. It's treacherous for staff and students, especially the staff in their parking areas in the back. We have a great field where we could utilize for help. Buses, like we said, are an issue, and early childhood centers. We have babies, three-year-olds, who aren't getting home until 5:30 at night, and school's over at 3:30. It's ridiculous, you know? As staff, we can't be required to stay with the children, but as my colleague talked, it happens frequently. Please take these comments and this situation seriously. I do speak for my entire staff and administration when I bring this to you tonight. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Our next speaker is Ms. Rhonda Clomax. Ms. Clomax, please come forward.
Good evening. My name is Rhonda Clomax, and I'm the principal at Turning Point Academy Public Charter School. I come to you this evening on behalf of the staff, teachers, students, and parents of Turning Point Academy Public Charter School with great humility, gratitude, and appreciation. I know it's not often that you are thanked, and especially thanked publicly, for all that happens in our schools on a daily basis. Words cannot express our school's delight in the commitment that Dr. Thornton, Mr. Burrows, Dr. Golson, Dr. Coley, and the entire school board of Prince George's County Public Schools had in ensuring that the opening of Turning Point Academy at Middleton Valley. To get to this point, there were many late evenings, weekends, long meetings, and conference calls. The district did not hesitate to paint vibrant and inviting colors when needed, replace countertops, install temporaries, buff floors, move furniture, and the list just goes on and on and on. However, it has been quoted, gratitude makes sense of our past, brings peace for today, and creates a vision for tomorrow. We no longer have water fountains leaking in the hallways, but two or three water coolers with cups in the four corridors which house our students. Orange and yellow paint lines our walls and doors. No longer do we have peeling paint in the hallways or rubber flooring coming up in multiple locations causing buckling. We have new tile in some classrooms and a reflection that can be seen in the floors as if our TPA community is in a Mop and Glow commercial. As quoted in previous testimony by one of our teachers, a school building tells students who they are and how they should think about the world. It can help to manufacture rote obedience, independent activity. It can create high self-confidence or low self-esteem. Well, my babies at Turning Point Academy should feel a sense of great self-worth, creative capabilities, and an educational community that truly loves, as evidenced in their refurbished school building. Finally, this would not be possible without the assistance of Dr. Mark Fawcett, Michael Herbstman, Sam Stefanelli, Barry Stanton, Dallas Pinckney, Jonathan Johnson, Clay Berry, Diana Wiles, Sean Matlock, Gail Huggins, Robin Evans, Stephanie Eugenes, Jonna Smar, Elizabeth Saunders, Loretta White-Khalid, Mr. Tony Boone, Joe Butler, Security Services, School Safety, Ms. Clarissa Brown, Maintenance, Plumbing, Electrical, Warehouse, Carpentry, Painting Departments. Again, thank you for your mighty endeavor and your trust in us and moving our school. This experience has been customer service at its best. Hashtag PGCPS proud.
Thank you, Ms. Clomax. Our next speaker is Ultra Hayes regarding Central High School. Don't see the person, so Our next speaker is Phyllis Wright. Ms. Phyllis Wright.
Good evening. My name is Phyllis Wright, and I'm a parent. I have two children at William Hall Academy. And the reason why I'm here today is because my daughter came home, and she said to me, "Mom, my classmates are crying because they don't have anything to eat. Can you and Aunt Belinda come up to the school to feed these babies?" And that broke my heart. So the next day, I went to witness to see what was going on. And I witnessed several children in there crying because they did not have anything to eat. They were sitting at the cafeteria with the head down. I touched a little girl. She was crying. And Lord have mercy, Jesus, I don't even want to start crying. But this is the lunch that they give them when they don't have any money. And what I don't understand is, if we can throw away food, why we can't feed these babies? Here we are in the United States of America, and we can't feed our own children. We have to do better. We have to do better. To give a child this that's there for 8 hours. Lunch and breakfast is maybe the only meal some of these kids receive. If we can't give them that first start, come on, we can do a little bit better. We can do a whole lot better. If we can give our CEO $1 million to get rid of them, we can find money to feed these babies. So come on, let's all of us get together. Because to give a child this, I'm gonna put this bag right here, sweetheart. This and this for all day, I don't think none of you all can strive on this. Now you tell me, how can a child learn if they have this? This is nothing. This is nothing. I don't understand. I don't understand how do we get to this point. But my daughter is 8 years old. When she came home to tell me that those kids was crying, the next day I went and I witnessed this for myself. So not only did she tell me this, I saw this. So you know what I had to do? I had to take money out of my pocket to feed these babies, not only my money, because I'm the president of the PTO. I had to use their money too, and I made sure that they gave me receipts because I thought this was unacceptable. Here we are only 3 weeks in school and we're not feeding our children. Now, I talked to Dr. Golson and she sent someone over there. When I witnessed this, I talked to Belinda Queen, and God knows we have to feed our children. I know you all have better things to do than not see these kids eat. Now, if you think this is something to give a child to eat that's gonna be in school all day, and then they tell me if they get a bag, they have to go in a separate room to eat this. This is degrading. This is degrading to me, degrading to the parents. Come on, please, let's feed these children. Every child in this school must have a decent meal. If they can throw away food at the end of the day, and they are throwing it away because I witness this as well. I'm always there. I'm there every day, and I'm only there because my babies, all of those babies are my babies. And when they have a problem, so do I. So I'm asking you all, please, let's do better than this. Let's do better than this. This is.
Thank you, Ms. Thank you, Ms. Wright, for your comments.
Thank you.
The next speaker is Shatra Chambers.
I'm gonna leave this here for you all.
Thank you, Miss.
There you are.
Thank you, Miss Wright.
So you know what them babies get.
Thank you, Miss Wright. Miss Chambers, please come forward.
Good evening. My name is Shatra Chambers, and I stand before you as a parent of a third grader at Phyllis C. Williams Spanish Immersion School in Largo. I'm also a proud bilingual PGCPS substitute teacher, focusing specifically on our immersion schools where there is usually a lack of substitute teachers, but that's a separate issue for a separate time. At PEW, we are a dynamic community of parents, students, and teachers who have started our school year with a wonderful welcome, courtesy of our PTO, and we were even featured on local news station Fox 5. And I appreciate, Dr. Thornton, that you invoked Toni Morrison and the value that she placed on communication, written, and oral. If you speak Spanish, you can communicate with approximately 80% of the world. Our goal of raising and educating bilingual, biliterate, and bicultural children is alive and well at PEW. Every year, we embrace new teachers from different parts of the Spanish-speaking world, which increases cultural awareness in our students. Many families participate in activities outside of the classroom, including upcoming Hispanic Heritage Month activities. I'll be taking my daughter to the Air and Space Museum this Saturday to highlight various contributions from Latino communities in air and space history. I believe in practical application of the language, so travel is a large part of our lifestyle. We spent time in places such as Cuba, Mexico, and have a goal of making our way around the 30-plus countries that recognize Spanish as one of their official languages before my daughter graduates high school in Prince George's County. This summer, we spent nearly 3 weeks in Guatemala, staying in a Mayan village with local families. Last month, my daughter had the privilege of meeting Dr. Alejandro Giamatei, who is the president-elect of Guatemala, and asked him what his first priority is once he takes office, all in Spanish, and she is 8 years old. This past April, my daughter and I took a group trip to Colombia, engaging in activities such as making oobleck from Dr. Seuss with kids at a youth outreach center that works to keep those kids in Colombia in positive programming. We also visited Palenque, the first settlement of freed slaves in Latin America. One of our photos of this experience was featured in Essence magazine. Last year, as part of my own continuing education, I attended a global education symposium that highlighted what the norm is in other countries in terms of foreign language exposure and immersion. Compared to those, we have work to do. If we're striving for excellence, we must be able to compete in the professional world of the future. This academic year is now underway for our first cohort of fifth graders in the Spanish immersion program. As many of these families are exploring middle school options, they and all of us in language immersion are in dire need of a viable solution for continuing our children's educations. We need our middle school. We're at a critical point. It's a critical point for holistic development for our students, and the academic environment has great impact on that experience. I referenced several examples in my earlier comments and hope that you can clearly understand that I did not enroll my child in this program for it to stop after elementary school. To many parents, that feels like time that could have better been spent elsewhere. We're in it for the long haul, and thank you for your commitment.
Thank you, Ms. Chambers. The next speaker is Marcel Martin. And if Ms. Carol Jones would prepare to speak next.
Good evening, board. I'm a parent of a student at Francis Fuchs Academy, or Francis Hughes Early Learning Center. And I'm here today really just to address the whole bus situation that you guys talked about earlier and the bus not showing up on time. Since the beginning of the year, the buses haven't been showing up for my son. It's been showing up either late or not showing up at all. And when it shows up late, it doesn't get there until about 9:25, and his school starts at 9:30. So he's one of those students that are coming to school at like 10 o'clock every day, and he's pretty much late every day. He's been late almost every day for the first 3 weeks of school. And I mean, yes, he's 4 years old. It's a, he's just starting out, but I mean, I don't feel like he's getting the right kind of services he should be getting when he's showing up to school late. Also, last Friday, he didn't get home until 6 p.m. He didn't get picked up from school until, I mean, really, I don't even know what time he got picked up. And that in itself is a safety issue. And that's why I'm even here. Because if I don't know what time he's getting picked up and he's not getting home until 6, for a 4-year-old, that is a danger. I don't know where he is. I don't know what time the bus is supposed to be there, when the bus is supposed to be at the house at 4:30. That's a problem. And the problem is the system that's set up for me to be able to call to find out what's going on. The phone's not working at Greenbelt. His bus comes out of the Greenbelt lot. The phone's not working at Greenbelt in the morning or in the evening, and it leaves the responsibility up to the staff members at Francis Fuchs to try to tell parents what's going on. They need to figure out either get information sent to the parents through the app, through the application, or someone at Greenbelt or someone at one of these central places need to be calling parents and letting parents know what's going on when their kid's not there, when they're supposed to be there. I need to know where my kid is all the time, when he leaves my house until when he gets home. So that's really why I'm here today. Also, I want to piggyback on what the previous staff member said about from Francis Fuchs about the parking at the school. It's horrendous. I drive a lot of people don't know, but I drive a truck that's pretty big. It's called a dually truck, and I can't turn around in the parking lot. Therefore, I have to park on the main road because I cannot pull my truck into Francis Fuchs. And that means me and my son have to walk on the street to go into the school. That's unsafe. The whole point of school is to create a safe environment. And the environment in Francis Fuse, between the buses not showing up on time, between them coming late, between the lack of parking at the school, is unsafe. And that's the whole point of the board. The board needs to do something about it, get connected with the parents and the principal, and come up with some solutions. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Martin. Ms. Jones, please come forward.
I am Carol Jones, treasurer of the Student Civic Association Incorporated. My presence here tonight is to encourage the board and everyone involved in the renovation remodel of Suitland High School to prioritize this great need in our community. My understanding is that we have not made major improvement in Suitland High School for 18 years. Just imagine how our homes would look if we did not address needed improvements for 18 years. Just as Suitland High School has been neglected, so has the Suitland community as a whole. It is even to the point that whenever new major businesses come to the area, they do not use Suitland as an address, such as Giant Food, District Heights, Chick-fil-A, District Heights, Suitland Community Center, District Heights, even our own Suitland High School, whose address has changed numerous times, Suitland, Forestville, District Heights. What good can come from Suitland High School? Let's just take a look. Steny Hoyer, attorney, politician, serving Maryland 5th Congressional District. Novova Bowman, football linebacker, college football at Penn State. San Francisco 49ers, Oakland Raiders. Rashawn Baker, former county executive, who thought it not robbery to send his kids to Suitland High. And my daughter, who graduated in 1999, who had the opportunity to visit France as part of the performing arts program, sing for their anniversary, visit the Eiffel Tower and Germany. Suitland is known for its CVPA, which is a four-year arts program that offers artistically talented high school students all over Prince George's County educational opportunities designed to prepare them for college, professional studies, or career options in the arts. The SEA has invited them numerous times to perform at our meeting to expose our community to our golden nuggets. We had supported them by our presence at concert as well as financially. I just want to take this opportunity just to say thank you to the board for giving us the opportunity to express our desires to have a vibrant Suitland High School. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your comments. The next speaker is Daniel Muth, Hyattsville Elementary PTA.
Hello, honorable council members. My name is Daniel Muth, and I'm a representative of the Hyattsville Area Schools, and I'm here in solidarity with the residents of Prince George's County. For too long, I've seen startling inaction when it comes to upgrading the dilapidated and overcrowded educational facilities housing our children. And I'm here to strongly urge every board member to vote yes when asked to approve the Alternative Construction Financing Package 1 and the identified 6 schools. Many of us are thankful and excited for the leadership expressed by this current body and this current capital improvement staff, showing the willingness to think outside the box and recognizing that waiting around for a solution to drop out of the sky without showing the imperative to lead is how $8 billion backlogs happen. It's how the can gets kicked, and it's how our schools fall down around our ears. It's how entire generations of school children end up falling through the cracks. What a powerful opportunity to be the group that ends all that. What a powerful opportunity to set the precedent that Prince George's County is going to lead the way out of its own problems, rather than waiting around for deliveries from somebody else that never arrive. Thank you so much for giving this serious and necessary consideration it deserves. I have great faith that the determination exists within this group to see it done. To some extent, this all started back in 2014 when the county wisely chose a comprehensive and transparent process to identify capital improvement priorities as listed in the 2015 master plan, a process that identified schools based on need and set the framework for how priorities would be addressed going forward. Unfortunately, those needs could not be addressed by traditional funding methods alone, and it became necessary to start thinking outside the box to tackle the deluge of problems. Our schools are in desperate need of a life raft. Roughly 2 years ago, the capital improvement staff started investigating public-private partnerships that could alleviate the most desperate of our capital improvement concerns. Capital improvement leaders and staff have responded to citizen emails, testified at our city council meetings, and shown up at city task force meetings to make sure the process was thorough and that alternative financing was well understood. And as mentioned in the board actions summary, public-private partnerships have been identified as a potential delivery method for Cycle One School since the 2017 Educational Facilities Master Plan. We've had years now to research and model this exercise and ponder its ramifications. So frankly, it's strange that some in this body would claim to have not been adequately informed. With respect, what have you been doing? We need schools now. We needed them yesterday. Let's put this pilot program into motion such that we can learn and continue to innovate solutions for the many schools in Prince George's County that have needs to address, such that we can take an important first step in reclaiming our self-determination, such that we can do the best we can for our kids. Please vote yes on alternative construction financing. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your comments, and thanks to all who came to speak to the board tonight. We'll now turn our attention to discussion item 4.01. Dr. Golson, I'll now yield the floor to you to present the MCAP results.
Thank you. The Maryland State Department of Education released the 2019 Maryland Comprehensive Assessment Program, better known as MCAP, results on August 27, 2019. Results from the 2018-2019 school year show improvements in English language arts for Prince George's County Public Schools, school students across all grade levels, including English 10, and growth in some but not all grades in mathematics. Nearly all elementary student demographic groups experienced growth in meeting or exceeding expectations on the English language arts exam. Our results mirror the gains and losses the state displayed last year. I'd like to thank our Division of Academic Staff who spent time this summer revising mathematics curriculum documents to make sure we could better serve our students. We're administering now quarter one and two benchmark assessments in mathematics for grades 3 through 8 and Algebra 1. This will also assist us in monitoring content implementation and quickly identify deficit skills that we must teach to ensure successful progress on the end of the year MCAP exam. For our parents, we created a school readiness guide for students in grades pre-K to 8, looks like this, that will allow parents to monitor their child's progress throughout the year and to make sure they are on grade level. That document will be released this week to all K-8 parents and placed on our website for easy access. And we have identified 18 schools that we're calling Bridge to Excellence schools. These schools are being closely monitored and provided additional central office support to teachers and instructional leaders to ensure that academic progress remains a priority through classroom visits, collaborative planning support, and targeted professional development. Of those 18 schools, I'm proud to announce that 14 have experienced gains in English language arts, mathematics, or in both areas for the 2018-2019 MCAP administration. Lastly, each school developed a school performance plan that will continue to guide our efforts as we improve in English language arts and strive to see gains in mathematics. At this time, I will have Dr. Strader, our Chief Academic Officer, walk us through our Maryland Comprehensive Assessment results for 2018-2019.
Dr. Thornton, Vice Chair Burroughs, members of the Board of Education, thank you for this opportunity to share these results. The presentation which I'm about to share with you is basically broken down into two parts. The first part summarizes the data in the way that the Maryland State Department of Education has shared this information during the August 27th State Board meeting, as well as how the information is presented on the Maryland Report Card website. The second portion of this presentation is going to address specific recommendations by Dr. Thornton, members of the board, and Dr. Goldson on doing a more apples-to-apples comparison of our student population compared to their similar peers across the state. Focusing first on English language arts, which during this presentation I'll regularly use the acronym ELA, so English language arts, ELA. I'll first focus on that. This first slide is an overview of our performance versus the performance of the state as a whole. It's broken down into the grade levels of 3 through 5, 6 through 8, and English 10. As you can see, across the three main grade levels, there's a gap of approximately 14 percentage points between our performance and that of the state. Taking a closer look within each grade span and student group, focusing here again on English Language Arts grades 3 through 8, two particular areas to highlight are the performance of our Black or African American population, as well as our population of two or more races. Also noteworthy is our performance of our FARMS, free and reduced meals, population of students, also an indicator of social economic status. Transitioning to high school, the ELA test at the high school level is the end of course English 10 test. The main highlight on this slide is the performance again of our Black or African American students outperforming the state by roughly 4 percentage points. Switching focus now to mathematics. This slide provides an overview of our mathematics performance across the grade level, similar to that was presented earlier in English Language Arts. There are similar trends in mathematics, however, the gap in our performance compared to the state is roughly 16%. The noticeable difference is within our elementary grade levels, where you'll see a difference of roughly 4 percentage points. But again, similar to what you're seeing in the ELA performance. Taking a closer look at the grade span and student groups, here's the performance at grades 3 through 8. Again, our Black or African Americans are performing at the same level as the state. All other subgroups are lagging, however. Similar results are seen here with an Algebra 1, which is the high school test used to assess mathematics. We now turn our focus to how have we performed over time. As Dr. Goldson mentioned in our intro, our performance, our trend performance, the comparison of our results from last year to this year actually mirror that of the state. Everywhere the state increased, each of the grade levels, each of the student groups, we also experienced an increase. Everywhere the state declined, we also experienced a decline. This slide shows the trend for English Language Arts grades 3 through 8 over the past 4 years. While math has remained relatively flat, English Language Arts has increased significantly. At the high school level, it's important to note the increase in English Language Arts. This is significant when considering the number of retesters. So what is represented here includes the population of all students. Because the high school assessments are also part of the Maryland State graduation requirements, the population of students presented here includes both first-time test takers and retesters. So looking at the population, the performance of our English Language Arts test, that increase is significant. When looking at the mathematics piece, that noticeable decline between 2017-2018, that's where your major onslaught of the retesters hit our population of students. And you can see with the increase there, we're experiencing a population shift, you have a decrease in results. This is broken out in this slide here. So we've taken that population of all test takers and broke them out by first-time test takers, retesters, and you can see in green the all test takers, which mimics the line from the prior slide. As you can see, for English Language Arts grade 10, both the retester population as well as the first-time test taker population have increased, especially looking at that first-time test taker population line. That is significant. Algebra 1, however, tells a bit of a different story. Again, I shared with you in 2018, that was when the graduation requirements kicked in and we had the retesters enter the population of students. Within the table, you can see how the end counts varied, which are representative of the dots on the line graph itself. In 2017, retesters comprised of 376 students. In 2018, that number jumped to almost 5,000 students. So with those retesters being added into the population of the first time test takers, that's why you're seeing that significant drop in those first couple of years. So it is important to note that between 2018 and 19, our repeaters are actually increasing in their performance. We still have to pay close attention to our first time test takers. This trend is consistent to the trend that we see across the state. The purpose of this slide is to view the data in terms of the graduation requirements. In previous slides, proficiency is defined as earning a performance level of 4 or 5 on the state assessment. For graduation purposes, passing is defined as earning a performance level of 3, 4, or 5. So you have an inclusion of an entire of the performance level 3 to the data. So that's the difference between the two. And you can see this follows a similar trend as earlier, but the passing percentages are considerably higher. So to summarize, the data does mirror that of the state. And what I've shared again was the direct comparison of our overall Prince George's County Public Schools performance to that of the state performance. So when I say we're comparing these two populations, in the previous slides, we've compared the populations that are actually broken down here by race. As you can see on the left side, the column on the left side represents the breakdown, the racial breakdown within Prince George's County Public Schools. The right side represents the breakdown of the state of Maryland as a whole. When presenting this information in the past, the question is, are we truly doing an apples to apples comparison when we're looking at student performance across the state? So what we've done is we requested of the State Department the actual student level data of the entire state assessment program. So in other words, we receive record for record the test results of every student across the state, of which obviously were deducted for privacy purposes. But this enabled us to be able to compare our performance of our student groups to similar student group performance across the state. Now, what I'm going to share in the next few slides is going to focus on the Black or African American piece there, that's what you see in the blue, as well as the red, which is the Hispanic or Latino population. The reason why I'm not sharing information regarding the other races near the top of the column there is because I'm going to go through a two-tier analysis here with you. I'm going to take those two subgroups and I'm going to break them down by the service groups. So we're going to look within the Black or African American population, we're going to break that down by their performance in special education, farms, EL, etc. If you take the small groups up at the top and we break them down by those subgroups, their counts become too small to report without violating privacy issues within our students. So I just want to be clear that we do value and will continue to research all of our races, but however, for the purpose of this, to honor our privacy, to comply with our privacy laws, we're going to focus on those two primary. So the first question that we're going to address is going to be, what percentage of our students comprise that of the state? That was one of the questions that was brought up on our calls. This slide here shows, again, what you're seeing, the full column represents the entire population of the state. So what you see in blue is the percent that Prince George's County Public Schools attributes to that population. So just to summarize what's on the screen, Prince George's County Public Schools comprises roughly a third of the EL population of the state, a third of the Hispanic population of the state. We comprise roughly a quarter of the free and reduced meals population of the state, quarter of the Black or African American population of the state. We roughly comprise 15% of the entire population of the state, as well as when you look at the students with disabilities, we comprise roughly 15%. So this shows you how actually Prince George's County Public Schools can influence the data. Filtering on Black or African Americans within Prince George's County Public Schools and across the state tells us a very different story than what was shared earlier. Focusing first on the English language arts results in grades 3 through 5, within this particular subgroup, you can see that Prince George's County Schools actually exceeds the performance of the state in all student groups. This also is the case in grades 6 through 8, our middle school levels, with the exception of our EL population. It's still very close. To say that again, within our Black or African American population of students in grades 6 through 8, at the subgroup level, the student service group level within that population of students across the state, Prince George's is outperforming the state. Transitioning now to English language arts, grade 10 assessment. Similar trends can be seen here as well, with the exception of not having a significant change there when you're looking at the non-English proficiency students, as well as your non-farm students. All other student groups, you can see Prince George's County Public Schools is again outperforming the state. Now that was in English language arts. Transitioning to math, the story isn't quite the same. At the elementary grades, grade levels 3 through 5, our struggles become apparent. Our farms students, however, you can see their performance is noteworthy in that it is pretty much unchanged. It's on parallel with the state. The rest, there's some work to be done. At the middle school level, again, we're in mathematics here, grade 6 through 8. It's interesting to note that we exceeded the performance of the state in all student groups. So again, if you focus on the free and reduced meals columns, that's the second set of columns, the fourth set of columns, which are our EL students, and the final, that sixth set of columns, which is our special education students, we've actually exceeded the state in the performance of those areas. At the high school level, Algebra 1, this remains to be a concern. Our performance is outlined here, and we do continue to lag behind the state. So transitioning now to our Hispanic or Latino population. I'd be remiss if I didn't share the context of the differences in these populations that are being presented here. In particular, when making the comparisons to our Hispanic or Latino population compared to that of the state, one major difference is the percentage of newcomers we have to this district compared to the percentage of newcomers that impact the rest of the state. In 2018-19, the population of our newcomers entering into this student group just about doubled. In 2017 and 18, the population of newcomers was 1,564 students. In 2018-19, that population increased to 2,846 students. So within that 1 year, our newcomer population, again, almost doubled. When you think of this in the context of how roughly 24,000 test takers are represented within this data, if you look back at the newcomers over the last 3 years and you overlay the newcomers on the data, they make up almost a third of the test population that you see included in the data here. Okay, so again, that percentage is very different than what you see across the state. So I just want to make sure we're clear that although I'm trying to say that this is an apples to apples comparison, a big variable here is our first time, our EL kids, as well as those students that transition out of EL but have still been within receiving services within the last 3 years. So keep that in mind. I just wish to put that out there as we go through the slides. So English language arts, grades 3 through 5. Here you can see that our performance of our students are lagging behind the state with the exception of our non-English proficiency students. Transitioning to middle school levels, our free and reduced meals in ELL, in our EL populations actually exceed that of the state. The other areas, though, we are lagging, somewhat slightly in some, more so in others. Our struggles are evident in English 10. Transitioning to mathematics, our struggles are evident in pretty much all grade levels of mathematics. This slide is representing grades 3 through 5. Keep in mind in mathematics too, all students, all newcoming students' data is included within these results. What do I mean by that? In English language arts, newcoming students for the first year are exempt from taking the actual MCAP tests, the ELA tests. Instead, they take what is called the ACCESS test. It's an English proficiency test. So they're actually excluded from the data, the first year EL kids. Mathematics, those students aren't included. I'm sorry, in mathematics, those students are included. So this is all students within this data set here. So you're gonna more greatly feel the impact of those newcoming students within mathematics more so than you're gonna feel that in ELA. Okay. So again, elementary, transitioning now to middle school. This is the performance in grades 6 through 8 mathematics. Lastly, this is the performance at our high school level in Algebra 1. So with that said at this time, we'll address any questions that you may have.
Thank you, sir, and Dr. Golston. Colleagues, I'll now call on Mr. Wallace for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you, administration, for that presentation. My questions center largely around the work that both the board and the administration has done around educational equity. When I was looking at the data, just a question dawned on me. Other than the ELA and English assessments, were the assessments given to students who may have limited English proficiency, was it given to them in their native language?
For the most part, no. Few students in mathematics were able to access the assessment in their native language. It's mostly English. I would say no.
Okay. And from my recollection is that the state does allow us to administer those assessments in their native language.
So a lot of research has been done in that area. They're allowed to take the assessment in their native native language and mathematics only. And the research in that area is about the instruction and how students are instructed to ensure that they are able to access that accessibility feature seamlessly. So again, the research has been somewhat sketchy on that. So within Prince George's County and within districts, they need to go through an assessment process to make sure that the students are in fact instructed in that mode of delivery, and then they can access the test that way. We've implemented that looking forward in MCAP to, with the future assessment program to see if we can even implement that.
Okay. So our biggest, as a system, our biggest hurdle is the mode of delivery more so than the availability to assess the students in their native language. So we need, do we recommend that the board, I don't want to put words in Mr. Montero's mouth on that committee, but the board's academic achievement committee look into how the board can support the administration in expanding modes of delivery in students' native languages?
So that means that their everyday delivery must be in that language.
Okay. My next question, 2 minutes left, is around student-based budgeting, and particularly unlocked and locked plus positions, and mainly around English as second language teachers and ESOL pairs. Has there been any discussion in the near or distant future and changing the classification of those positions so that our principals are not hamstrung between picking a data coach or another math teacher in support of getting more ESOL support for their students, particularly our newcomers?
Right. So our conversations are not specifically around ELL, but it is around looking at SBB and allowing our elementary principals to complete a survey to look at the advantages or disadvantages of continuing to follow SBB. What we find in our secondary schools is that the ability to do that has been a benefit to them and not necessarily so much at elementary, but we are waiting, we will be doing a survey to receive feedback from our elementary first.
Thank you. And my last question is around SBB again, but the idea of having, I don't want to say a pool of money, but I know that in our research from the Equity Task Force, Ms. Rhodes, a lot of our students that do come to our region, and Prince George's specifically, come from nations that have an academic calendar that ends in December when ours ends in June. And so while they may come to our nation and our region thinking that they're starting a school year anew, they're actually in the middle of our budget and our academic calendar, and our schools are hamstrung with funds and resources. Is there any way in administrative law or in the board's policy that we could have a sitting pool of money so that when a school does get an increase of 10%, 15% of students that may need some additional supports, that we can then tap into that pool of money and help those schools?
So we get a per pupil expenditure amount based on our September 30th enrollment. Whether the child comes in December, January, February, we're still gonna have that set amount. And so we know we had not looked at creating a fund for students who come after that date.
Thank you, Mr. Wallace. Mr. Montero. Guess Mr. Thomas, was it you or Mr. Valentine? Mr. Valentine, was it you? Mr. Montero's light came on, so it might be a mix up, but Mr. Valentine.
It always happens, so we'll get compared to one another. Thank you very much for your presentation. I'll just say this does speak to a previous comment from one of the members of the community who asked how we compare our schools to other districts and why Prince George's County often gets rated rather low by these national rankings. But when I talk to parents who ask me why I send my children here or why they should send their children here, it's because some of the data you mentioned today that we educate African American students particularly better than any other district in the country. And I bring this up for different reasons. One, I know I'm don't apologize for as having attended a historically black college. And the idea that many people send their children to historically black colleges because those schools uniquely prepare African Americans for the workforce, that schools that are ranked higher can't do, regardless of where they are. And so where Morehouse College fits on the rankings of, say, liberal arts colleges in America, it's not very high. But when people say, I have a black son, I want to send him to a college that's going to train him, I want to send him to Morehouse. At the same time, as a parent of two children, when I talk to my children, I don't want them to be the best black student. That's not my goal for Ivy or Curtis Valentine. It is to be the best student, period. When I go into work every day, I'm not the best black, I'm the only black person where I work, that's all the conversation. But I don't walk in thinking they're gonna treat me differently because I'm black, I'm gonna be the best black person. I want to be the best, period. And so my question is very clear. What is the plan to ensure that not only are we be the best system to produce black students, but to produce black, to produce students, period, in Maryland? What is a strategy to ensure that we are reaching the schools, the classrooms, the student body that are at the lower end of this, because we did not break it down by school, by region, and things like that. And I imagine there are probably certain schools that are pulling a lot of this data down and have been doing so for a very long time. And what is our plan to address those particular schools more directly so that we're not concentrating on our comparison within racial categories, which again, for anyone who's wondering whether to send their child, particularly if they're African-American Latino, then this is still the best place in the state to do so. But how we ensure that when we educate children, that we're not limiting them that to just their race or their ethnic background, but to a standard that the state has set. In many ways, the state is even too low for me because I'm looking at an international standard. And what are we doing, particularly in those schools that we know is pulling us down? And in those schools that are doing well, what are they doing that we can compare and replicate? And that's with all our schools, whether it be magnet, whether it be charter, whether it be specialty schools. What are they doing in those schools so well that we can't replicate that in some of the other schools? And that's my only question.
So as I stated in the introduction earlier, my team and I took some time last school year to look at schools that we identify that continue over time to have lower assessment results. And of those, we identified 18 schools. And as I stated earlier, as we got the results back for the 2018-19 administration of MCAP, 14 of those 18 had increases in English language arts, mathematics, or both. And so we'll continue to provide support and monitor those 18. Of those 18, there are obviously four remaining. And two of those four, we've already made some instructional changes that'll take place, or leadership changes, and looking at ways to begin to identify strategies that will help us to continue to move instruction. Our focus this year has been about what takes place in the classroom. It's on grade level teaching and learning that takes place every single day. And as most folks know, I have given a charge to our administrators to go back into the classroom. It's an opportunity for us to continue to focus on where it has to take place every day. I'm expecting that our principals and our assistant principals will be in the classroom to monitor instruction. And to monitor it means that you have to look at the curriculum guide, you have to know the content that's being taught, and you have to provide content feedback that will allow our teachers to move our students forward. In addition, as I stated earlier, we're adding additional benchmarks, because what we had not done, unfortunately, is we focused on English language arts and we did not focus on numeracy. And so now we are focused on numeracy and English language arts literacy at the same time. And by adding quarterly benchmarks for mathematics, we are now able to monitor student achievement.
Just one final question with 3 seconds left. Is there a plan, or would you be willing to discuss allowing certain schools to have certain autonomy and being more flexible in order to be more aggressive, particularly in those 14 schools, whether it be around hiring, around length of school day, and other strategies that would be a little more aggressive in schools that we know are historically underperforming?
So what we do know is that we just negotiated contracts, so the additional extended day would have to be, that's a contract negotiation piece. But of those 18, what we also did was take the time to look at what we had done for many of those schools over a 10-year time period. autonomy is one of the strategies that we had utilized over that 10-year time period, and we have data to show that the autonomy did not necessarily help to improve student achievement. And so for those 18, we'd have to do an even deeper dive to see what that would look like. We've tried almost everything in some of those schools, honestly, but now what I've done is decided to take a change in leadership and a focus on instruction.
Thank you. Ms. Williams.
Thank you for the presentation. I appreciate you all diving into the data and comparing apples to apples, because I think it's very important. When you look at the slides, well, all the slides where you compare Prince George's County to the state, my first question is, when you did the comparison, did you take Prince George's County out of the state number, or did you keep them in?
No, they're out. So they're out. Prince George's versus all others.
Okay. So one of the things that I think what's important for us to really look at it are the trend data. Uh-huh. And when Dr. Golson mentioned that we mirror the state, when we are representing 15% of that state population, when we increase, the state will increase. So our target continues to move. And so because our gap between the state number is so large, if we were to increase that 17% difference,
it would move.
The state would move. Mm-hmm. So that is just something that I think is interesting when we are being compared to other jurisdictions. They compare the overall number, but we have to continue to push that over the years, 16, 17, 18, 19, we're on a positive trend. And I think that's the first thing that we really have to hone in on, is that we are moving in the right direction. The one sobering number that I look at being a STEM person, a science person, is the math number. Math is scary to so many people. I don't understand why, but it's very scary. Mm-hmm. Is there a plan, or is there an opportunity for us to look at allowing students to have extra work at home on their own, meaning using some of those applications, ABC Mouse, those things that help students practice, but it's fun? Because I think the one thing that I see in the data when you break it down, there clearly is a separation between the economics, the language, and what happens at home. So if we're able to provide opportunities for students to log in at home and practice, we may not get 100%.
Right.
In any category, the ELLs, farms, non-farms, we may not get 100%, but if we capture just a small portion of that, those kids to practice at home, we can monitor that at home. You know, they have all those monitoring tracking programs. If we can capture just a few, I think we can begin to reduce that gap. Some kids will practice, some kids will not. But for those that do, I think it could be a positive impact on our scores, especially when it comes to the math. And really, it's a math, it's building on that base foundation. And if you don't have that base foundation, when you get to algebra, you're not going to get it. There is nothing that you can do except practice to improve that score. So if we could look into, and since I sit on the Academic Achievement Committee, that is something that I really want us to look at, is if we can provide an opportunity for students to practice at home, those that want to, that could help us improve. On Dr. Golson, on the 18 schools that you looked at that we are targeting, was that across all grade levels or just elementary?
Elementary, middle, and high.
Okay, across all grade levels. And I think that's all. And well, K. Alexander Wallace, my colleague, he mentioned SBB. And I really think that we should look at the SBB, how we do that calculation, because as we saw, it's across the board in some areas where we're having challenges. And maybe when we're looking at economics, language challenges, and things like that, we may need to consider some other form of criteria for distributing finances for the schools. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Williams. Ms. Queen.
Thank you, Dr. Thornton. Thank you for the breakdown, first of all, Dr. Golson and your staff. A couple of questions. When you mentioned 18 and then you went down to 14 and then you said some extra help was put in the school, and I'm not actually publicly asking you to name the schools, but I would like to know what schools they are, if you can get me a copy of the schools and what type of extra help was put in there. As we talk about equity and equality in our schools, we want to make sure that every need is met and that every child is being treated fairly at all of our schools, and that's very important to me, that we level the playing fields for these children to learn. One of the things that my colleague did say, that Kennard did say, he asked a question about the test being, and which is very important, especially the math. I know the English you said they didn't, but with the math test for the ones who just come in from foreign countries, you said they've taken that test. So why couldn't, like when we send out flyers, we have it in English and Spanish, why couldn't that test be both ways and they can compare it and look, because it may help them. So we may want to think about having it in their different language and in the English language when they first take the test. I mean, after they hear a while and they learn the English language, I can see that it may no longer be a need, but at first, when they're first taking the test, they may need both languages, and that may help improve in that area. Another thing is, I wanted to know, if we, and I mentioned this several times before, and I will keep saying it, why we're not reaching out to our embassies to assist for programs to assist to help find some things that would help our kids, whether it's after school or before school or whatever. We got to learn to reach out to our embassies. These are their children too, although they're here in America, but they come from other countries. We have to learn to reach out to our embassy for resources to help us educate these kids. So I will continue to say that that extra pool of money that Kennard was talking about could come from them. Another thing is, we need to be more creative with having more after-school programs. I know one of the things you said, a contract has already been done, Dr. Golson, but if we have after-school programs at all of these schools and we use our community partners or other specialty programs, this will kind of like assist, whether it's similar to the after-school program my colleague Sonia was talking about, whether it's something that the kids have at home they're able to do, not just them. Sometimes their parents need a little bit of help. But if we have some type of program that can help all of our residents and all of our children to be the best they can be, then that would be appreciated. So I'm wondering if you guys can really think about doing this for our students, because it's really important. Some money could come to do it. It really will help, and it will bring these test scores up if we can do that.
Thank you, Ms. Queen. Ms. Samet.
Dr. Strader, thank you so much for presenting these results. Essentially what I see is that we've made some progress, but there's still a lot of work left to be done. And what I'd appreciate is as a follow-up to this presentation, that's all I'm going to ask for at this time, is a follow-up, is a plan of action of how we're going to increase student learning in those areas that need improvement, specifically the factors that contributed to all of the scores that are below the state average for each category, and then also a detailed outline of what will be done beyond what's already happening in every area where we're behind. I think that would help contextualize and at least provide me some solace to know that we're taking additional steps and efforts to address student learning in those areas where it's clear that we're not where we could or should or want to be. Is that possible?
Actually, we have that information prepared, and it'll be shared in the academic subcommittee for the board on next Tuesday.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Yes, and Ms. Amant, I want to thank you and your committee again for taking the leadership on this particular area of focus. Clearly, board meetings of this type, while useful, cannot get to the kind of analysis and in-depth analysis that we need. And so we look forward to the work of your committee in that regard. Mr. Omolola.
Dr. Golson, I had a couple questions about the 18 schools that you had mentioned. I know you said there was a change in leadership, but I wanted to follow up with the department heads for each within the schools.
Look at my husband.
I wanted to follow up with the department heads at the 18 schools. Are you aware if there was a change in like the math department heads? Because I know many at times the instruction and the curriculum can change, can vary based on the department heads.
So that should not be. We have a prescribed curriculum that's taught by grade level across the district. A change in leadership at a school level does not change the curriculum.
Okay.
So if there were any changes, it's because we made those revisions to the curriculum documents, not because of leadership changes at the school level.
Gotcha. Then an additional question that I wanted to echo from my board colleague, Ms. Queen. Are we reaching out to our neighboring universities, Bowie State University, University of Maryland, to offer opportunities for them to tutor students? Because I remember when I was in eighth grade, and Dr. Curry can remember this pretty well, we had tutors from University of Maryland come and teach us for our eighth grade honors classes for math. So I wanted to know, are we following up with our community partnerships and the colleges to actively work with students? Because I know many at times, and no offense to the middle-aged teachers, but it's difficult to learn from somebody with a large age gap and learning from somebody with a shorter age gap, as I've seen, produces better results.
I'm going to try to go ahead and save you here, Joshua, since I am a middle-aged educator. Yes, we do. We have lots of partners who help to support our students before and after school. Many times it doesn't have to be just university partners. We have sororities and fraternities who commit time weekly, consistently, to provide support to students. And then we have partnerships, like you gave an example of Bowie State, who myself and Dr. Coley just met with yesterday, who are looking at ways to continue to also support those 18 schools as well.
And my last and final question, I won't offend anybody, I promise. It's to the instruction portion of what we're learning. I know that Algebra 1 is the main test that we really fall short in. So I wanted to see, is there a comprehensive plan for middle schools that lead up to that test from 6 to 8?
So actually, if we go back and look at the data, where you would find the deficit skills for mathematics were 3 to 5, and then Algebra 1. If we were able to go back at that slide, you would see in the presentation 6 through 8, we had a slight gain. Across the board, we have a lot that we must do in mathematics. And as I stated before, unfortunately, what we did several years ago was really just focus on literacy and not do numeracy at the same time. And so what we are now seeing are the effects of what happens when you don't do them hand in hand. And so we'll continue to see gains in English language arts, but now we've got to do a deeper dive and provide even more support in mathematics. And what's even more different is that you're also dealing with content knowledge and pedagogy and trying to teach the foundations of mathematics in order, as our board member, Ms. Williams, said, you've got to know that foundation piece in order to be successful in Algebra 1.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. And I did misspeak. Mr. Montero chairs our academic affairs committee, so I misspoke. I'm sorry, Mr. Chair. Mr. Murray.
Good evening, all. Before posing any questions, I kind of wanted to contextualize kind of the region's progress as I see it from what I understand. So I think since 2015, our neighbors in DC are up 10 points on ELA and math combined. Our neighbors in Montgomery County are up almost 7 points. We're up 1.5 points. It feels like we're making very, very slow progress towards getting our students to the college-ready mark that we know they need to be at. And I guess every year administration always has a plan. And my question is, what leads us to believe, why should we have confidence that our plan this year is going to change the results, because we have the same schools, the same grades, and the same neighborhoods performing similarly year after year after year, putting, you know, sometimes 5%, 5 out of 100 kids on track to go to college, and we know where the schools are. And so why should we have confidence that this year's plan is going to give those kids what they need, because we know they can do it, and so we're not putting something in on the input end that they need?
So let me answer the second one first and then go back to your first one. It's about consistency. What we have done is that we continue to keep changing. And so we have to stay steady with our plan that we have before us now. You could see the growth on the slide there for what happened in English language arts, and that's because we had a plan and we followed it. And the same has to take place. Let me reassure everyone here, it is not going to happen overnight. It is not. But being consistent and continuing to provide that support, I believe, and I know, because our staff and our teachers are doing exceptionally hard and doing the work to ensure that we continue to have gains over time. When you spoke about Montgomery County and DC in terms of our English language learners, once again, that brings us back to the slide that Dr. Strader shared earlier. We have doubled the number of English language learners. So once again, when you begin to compare us to others, you've got to compare us to jurisdictions that have the same number of ELL students. We have not districts that have a third or a fourth of what we provide support to.
Mr. Wallace, for 3 minutes, and Ms. Queen, and
wasn't
then,
that
I'm sorry. I
hear that point. I'm very aware of the challenge that our school systems face, and I guess I'm looking more towards solutions. I mean, we know what our populations are increasing towards. I mean, what is the percentage of our bilingual teachers? What is the percentage of our Latino teachers and school leaders in the system? And how are we making sure that we're reflecting that growth that we see in students? I mean, there's things we know that work, and I don't see us keeping up with the change in our students.
Well, we actually had this conversation last spring when we did a presentation from Human Resources about ways to attract bilingual and Latinx teachers. We had Mr. Rivera, who went to a university this summer to begin to establish a pipeline of teachers that we would have the opportunity to potentially move here from Texas, who are already in a program getting their master's degree to become teachers, already teachers, but will be able to move here to begin to increase our pipeline. We shared those strategies, and we were grateful that we have an opportunity to partner with Howard University and the University of Texas in order to begin to do that. And so I believe that based on that partnership, the beginning conversation started in July, that we'll be able to move forward and do those kinds of increases that we plan to do. In addition, our Chief of Human Resources also has worked with her team to begin to do a Latinx pipeline. So we've done a pipeline for our own employees, but we want to begin to do that from our own Hispanic employees that are in the system.
And I guess lastly, I'd like to see our system be more innovative in terms of, I mean, when are we going to see our schools rolling out extended school days? When are we going to see our schools starting to embrace home visits? When are we going to see us doing things that jurisdictions around us are doing that we know work? And I know there's complications with labor negotiations and all kinds of other things, but if there's things that we know can work for kids, what are we waiting for?
So that's a great example of the introduction that I shared this before we started our board meeting, that we now have an evening CTE program where our students are working during the day and then getting their high school diploma and their CTE certification. That's the out-of-the-box innovative thinking that the Board of Education approved financially at this last in June in order for us to support. And though the numbers are still low, it's the beginning of changing that innovation. And so I believe that over time we'll continue to do that. We've been able to do it through CTE in two areas, the evening program as well as in our own apprenticeship program.
Thank you, Mr. Murray. Mr. Wallace and Ms. Queen, and then we will proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And just a follow-up to Ms. Queen's points, and thank you, Ms. Queen, for that, for your comments. When we talk about mode of delivery, Dr. Strader, just for my confirmation, our assessments are given on laptops or Chromebooks,
uh-huh.
Yes. They still are. Okay. The mode of delivery of the curriculum, is that largely based in terms of technology for all of our classrooms? Do all of our students have access to all of our students that are assessed? Do they have access to technology year round?
Yes.
Okay. Finally, my comment, I don't see Dr. Jackson here, but around the Family Institute and the engagement of our parents in our communities. As we all see, our struggles are mostly in math, and I think we need to shift the community's understanding and acceptance of mathematics. A lot of folks fear numbers, quite honestly. We speak English every day, but a lot of folks don't speak numbers every day in their day-to-day lives and their jobs. And I think Mr. Burrow said it at one of our meetings last year, you cannot pass down something that you don't know yourself. And so if you graduate high school only taking Algebra 1 Geometry, and then you have a child that wants to, like me for example, wants to take AP Calculus, there's no way that my parents could have supported my endeavors. I had to rely solely on my high school AP Calculus teacher, who was only available from 8:30 to 4:30. Is there any way that our school system and maybe the board can look at this in our budget season, in expanding the scope of the Family Institute to be more than just engaging parents around a holistic services, but also reinvigorating their knowledge themselves in mathematics so they can still pass it down to their children.
Ms. Queen.
Hold on, the administration didn't answer the question.
I was looking at them for an answer and I didn't.
I was trying to push you faster. We are open to looking at that. It's important to know that the mathematics that our students experience now is totally different than what I learned in school, which really was just around numbers. Our students are asked to justify their responses, use mathematical reasoning to explain how they arrived at their answer. So it's more than just coming up with just a simple response. And so the writing component piece is still instrumental. And you also have to understand the key terms. And so I agree that there's still work that needs to be done so that our parents can support our students. But at the same time, we do, even if our parents are not prepared, provide several resources that they can utilize so that their child still can move forward in their content area.
Dr. Thornton, my follow-up. Has there been an assessment on the earlier years and our lack of growth due to the administrative leave issues that we had maybe 2-3 years ago, and the lack of continuation of teachers of record in front of our students, particularly in math and English language arts?
We have not done an analysis through research and evaluation related to that. What I can tell you is that many of the changes that we made for the mathematics curriculum were based on comments from our teachers and their ease of being able to navigate through our curriculum in order to teach the content that they needed to do.
Thank you, Mr. Wallace. Ms. Queen.
Thank you so very much. So I'm glad Mr. Wallace asked these questions and you gave him an answer, but mine was around math also. Maybe we need to go back to the basic math that was taught when we went to school. It is a big issue, and I think math has been a big issue, as Mr. Wallace just stated, because just by using my daughter, one of my kids, for example, she didn't have a math teacher at Central last year. I complained and sent a letter in, so after 60 days, the board is required to get a math. When they gave her a math teacher, he barely could speak English. So we do have a basic, we have a problem, because we can't expect our kids to be taught math or anything else in front of people who can barely speak English. It's hard for them to be able to get that. I think one of the things that Mr. Wallace addressed, we need to look at all of that. How can we expect our kids to learn something that already they have difficulty learning, and then we don't have the right type of teacher they can understand? So I think everything needs to be addressed and look at it when it comes to our kids learning certain things.
Thank you. Mr. Omalola, and then we'll proceed.
Dr. Golson, I had a quick question. For students taking the test, are they provided mock tests ahead of time on the laptops just to get comfortable with the way the test setting is?
So we've, luckily through our testing department, we've begun to do those kind of mock simulations so that they're done on the computer. But we have stressed this multiple times. You have to use technology ongoing through the delivery of instruction. It should not just solely be used when it's time to test.
Is that it, sir? Thank you. Mr. Burrows.
Good evening. I was very pleased to see how our students are doing, our African-American students are doing compared to the rest of the state. And so that's not something that I knew or assumed, and so I was very happy to see that. I also looked at some of the numbers, and I've been in a lot of discussions about our perpetually low-performing schools. You've done an analysis about all the things that we've tried. I'd like to see that menu of everything that we tried in those schools, because we can't continue to allow them to operate in the same way. I know I'm willing, I've spoken to a number of other folks who are willing to go to the unions and say for these schools, we have to do something different. And that could mean anything, but I feel like all options have to be on the table as it relates to those low performing schools. And I would hope that our labor partners would agree that education is a civil rights issue of our time, and we're not going to keep students in perpetually low-performing schools. That's just what it needs to be. And that is the commitment that we need to have with our labor partners around this. And so if we need to extend the school day, then that's what we need to do. We need to pay teachers more to go into those schools, and that's what we need to do. We're so blessed on this board to have an expert in this, you know, field, Mr. Valentine, and Mr. Murray, who lives it every day. And as I've been speaking to a lot of colleagues about what's happening nationally, there are a lot of examples of what we can do to turn around perpetually low-performing schools. And I think we need to explore those and implement those here in the county. I look forward to working with Mr. Montero's committee and the rest of the board to figure that out and to fight for that and to champion that. But you know, whatever I can do to help with that, I would like to do. With all that being said, I am very proud of our data for our African American students who we're clearly, you know, leading the state in that area, and that is something that, you know, Prince George's County should be proud of. I think we have to take it to the next level and disrupt this cycle of low-performing schools. And so I look forward to working with the unions to do that and my colleagues to do whatever makes sense. Because if those options have not worked, then we can't do those again. We have to do something different. And I think what will be required for us to do can only be possible with the help from the labor unions.
Thank you. Ms. Williams, then we'll hopefully move on.
Thank you. Thank you for allowing me to just make one comment. I just wanted to piggyback on Board Member Ahmed's request on the follow-up action plan, but I also wanted to piggyback on what Dr. Golson said about consistency. For the last few years, we've been in a weird space, and so I'm just glad that we are now able to be stable and be still and focus on certain outcomes. So when we look at the follow-up plan and the actions that we're going to take, I think it's important that we include the milestones of expectations. Because as Dr. Golson stated, we are not going to change this overnight. And we've seen a consistent increase in English, the ELA test, because we focused on the English language. We started writing in every class, in every grade, all the time. We talked about numeracy, but we did not take the same urgency as the English language test. But if we include the milestones and the expected outcomes, I think we also need to look at the impact that it may have on the state so we can be prepared for the movement of the state number and where we will sit on that in that total comparison. So I'd just like to see what those milestones would be when you talk about the programs that we're going to use, the expected outcome. If we meet it, great. If we don't, that's still okay, but then we have something to look at and discuss to see how we can improve that issue. But and then also the impact globally. When we increase our numbers, if we meet those milestones, the impact on the state, so it will not be a surprise if we're still looked at as second from the bottom. So thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Williams. Mr. Burrows.
What role do instructional directors play in this? I mean, I would assume instructional directors, you know, I assume they would be involved in being held accountable for the, you know, progress of the schools under them, but I'm not clear.
That is correct. Not only instructional directors, but the associate superintendents as well. And what they have each done this week in itself have had level meetings, elementary, middle, and high, where they have all looked at the performance data of students, analyzed it, and been very deliberate in working with members from curriculum and instructions for needed next steps to occur in every school. So, following those meetings, their role is to go out into those schools to monitor the turnkeying process of the learning that has taken place during those professional learning experiences. They are there with principals to support them. They participate in collaborative planning meetings. They have ongoing conversations with principals. And in addition to that, quarterly, they will be holding data conversations with each of their clusters.
Mm-hmm.
So as I'm saying what's going to happen quarterly,
okay.
But each week they are visibly in schools monitoring the instructional process.
I remember a meeting that Mr. Wallace and I had with the principal, I guess it was last year, was it?
Last spring,
and it was one of our chronically low-performing schools, and we asked, you know, what different support do you receive? She couldn't articulate any different support that she would receive versus any other school, and that was troubling to me, and I would hope that's changed, you know.
It has certainly changed, Mr. Burrows. The instructional directors were there previously, they're now as well. But in addition to that, there are additional members from curriculum and instruction that are there to support them and guide that process. They conduct learning walks and provide guidance on what is expected with regard to instructional delivery. So their presence now is more. We do have additional instructional directors, just as we have additional or change associate superintendents.
Right. Okay.
We also have coaches.
Mm-hmm.
That are there to support the work as well. Those coaches that are assigned to the area office that work in sync with the instructional directors to support the work as well.
And then also for principal placement, how are we incentivizing the best, most effective principals to enter in these spaces, and how do we give them the latitude over picking the staff that they need in order to run the building the best way possible?
Incentives, monetary incentives, we do not provide. We do provide support, physical support from individuals, as I indicated.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Mr. Burrows. And colleagues, I'll just make one comment, then we can move to the consent agenda. This is a very useful, if you give me no more than 5 minutes, I'll take two. It's a very useful discussion, and Dr. Golson, thank you and your staff for this presentation, particularly the contextualization of it, so that we can understand where we actually sit in the state. I spent all day before I came to the board meeting working with the Kerwin Commission work group, and that work group's work is so important to what the people of Prince George's County are hearing. What you're seeing the people of Prince George's County and our school leaders do is working with the resources that they have, and we're asking them to maximize the utilization of those resources. One of the things to the state's credit, Dr. Kerwin's credit, and our leadership's credit, is the understanding that we are grossly underfunding the capacity of our systems to address the issues that you hear here tonight. And I'm encouraged by the work of the leadership of the state in their growing understanding that there's massive undercapacity on the part of our school systems to address these issues. And I would expect the people of Maryland and people of Prince George's County to hear this discussion tonight, but also raise your level of involvement and consciousness to the systemic and structural issues that are burdening the capacity to address these issues. These issues relate to the maldistribution of capacity in terms of wealth distribution, in terms of residential income and commercial wealth distribution. We have 117 schools that are in this county that are 55% or more what we call economically needy. Now that's a bad maldistribution of burden that this county has to carry. What I'm looking for is the Kerwin Commission and the people of Maryland is to fund that impoverishment on the part of our babies. That's a state responsibility. Now the people of Prince George's County cannot just come to hear us talk about these issues at this level because you're in the box, you're kind of talking among yourselves. We have to make sure that there is a formula that drives resources that enables us to do what you're asking us to do. we can do more with what we have, and we must. Our CEO and this board will make sure that happens. But you be under no illusions that until we get more resources for our babies, that is paying teachers more, which we talk about, and you can't just talk about it, you have to demand it. Class size reduction, paying our principals more, you talk about sensitization for principals, paying them more. We do have the primary responsibility disproportionately for educating our new arriving LEP students. We have the primary responsibility for educating our students who, for no fault of their own, are impoverished. That's a larger economic question. But what we demand, we will demand on the part of the people of Maryland, is that we have a formula that drives those resources to our babies. Now, those decisions are going to be made in the next 2 months. You got to hear me. Those decisions are going to be made in the next 2 months. And then in the next General Assembly, the legislature is going to make decisions that are going to determine whether we can address these issues in a long-term structural way. Our babies are underfunded by billions of dollars. And that's not just a throwaway word, a phrase. So let's do both. Dr. Golson, we expect, obviously, you and your staff working with us to do all we can with what we have. But we're going to need to address the structural issues that's creating lack of capacity for our children. There is a clear, as gentrification takes place in the district and children are being pushed here, the district can do more because they don't have to deal with the same children. Children are not as poor there anymore as they were when my wife taught there 33 years ago. So we can't let this happen to our babies. And the only way you do that is that you have to have a state concept that removes children from their zip codes, where they live, and where their schools happen to live. If we can put these two things together, response from our leaders, from our academic leaders, this board demanding performance with a state concept, we can get it right. Thank you. It's okay. We'll now move to our consent agenda. Dr. Golson, would you please present those, and we'll pull 5.4.
Items 5.1 through 5.3 requires board approval of proclamations for Conflict Resolution Day, National Bully Prevention Month, and Red Ribbon Week.
Thank you. Mr. Wallace, a motion is in order regarding 5.1, 5.2, and 5.3 for discussion.
So moved.
It's been properly moved and seconded on 5.1, 5.2, and 5.3. Mr. Wallace.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just a quick question to the administration around item 5.02. Just as a follow-up for the past school year, could we get the data of any bullying and harassment reports made by our students or their parents to the administration and the timeline of which those reports were resolved?
Yes.
Thank you so much. And colleagues, to Ms. Amid's committee on policy, I'm just reading the policy on our board policy on bullying, harassment, or intimidation. This policy hasn't been touched, and by the time of our next school board meeting, it would have been 10 years. Just to put it on your docket for review, if we could, in the next board year.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. And I'll call the question on this. Those in favor, please say aye on 5.1, 5.2, and 5.3.
Aye.
Those opposing, no. The ayes have it. Motion is in order regarding 5.4 for discussion.
So moved.
Been properly moved and seconded that the board approves 5.4. Ms. Ahmed.
Yes. Dr. Mason, I just had a couple of questions. How are the optimal staffing numbers and ratios determined in this plan?
So the optimal staffing numbers and ratios are determined in this plan based upon several different factors. At the elementary level, our school district uses an hours-based staffing model. Hours-based staffing really ensures the equitable distribution of staffing resources to a school, not based upon the number of students in that school, but based upon the hours of service. And so neighboring jurisdictions have also moved to that same type of model at the elementary level because it provides the exact number of services based upon hours rather than the number of students. So for example, if a school has students who require far many more hours due to the nature of their disability, the formula then addresses that. So that's okay. An example at the elementary level.
Thank you. And then I know that we've been going through this phase out with CSEP. I'm interested in seeing how the CSEP students are doing in that process. So could you provide some student achievement data for the past couple of years as a follow-up item?
Absolutely. We monitor those students annually, and we do have that data, and that can be provided.
Okay, thank you. Please note that as a follow-up item, Ms. Tate. And then my last question here or comment, this might be directed to Dr. Goldson, is just I understand that I feel like every week, every other day, several times a week, there are concerns coming from parents about violations when it comes to IEPs, when it comes to special education, when it comes to the number of staff that are allocated, different issues around SPED. And I don't think that there's any way for folks to select that as an option if they were to go to our compliance hotline to report something like that. My request is, can that be reevaluated and reviewed so that an option can be provided on the compliance hotline to indicate if something is allegedly being violated when it comes to SPED?
That would be a question we have to pose to internal audit.
Okay.
We don't manage the compliance hotline.
Okay. All right, that's all for me. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Ahmed. Colleagues, the vote is on 5-4. Those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposing, no. The ayes have it. Dr. Goldson, we will now move to the budget consent agenda. Would you please introduce those? We're going to pull 6-3.
Item 6.1 and 6.2 requires board approval of the October 2019 expenditure requirements and the FY 2019 final operating budget transfer.
Motion is in order regarding 6.1 and 6.2. It's been properly moved and seconded by Mr. Wallace that we approve 6.1 and 6.2. Seeing no discussion, those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposing, no. The ayes have it. A motion is in order regarding 6.3 for discussion. It's properly moved and seconded that we approve 6.3. Ms. Ahmed.
All right, colleagues. So you all know that I'm very conflicted on this item. I'm conflicted on the resolution. Let me be clear on that. And the reason that I'm conflicted is 2.5 years ago, I was sitting on this dais and I was imploring and asking administration to look at alternative financing as an option. I was vocal and consistent with that over the course of two or three meetings. And that was coming with the mindset of being on the Board of Regents for the University System of Maryland, where the University of Maryland had individual philanthropists that were alum that went through their foundations to donate buildings, something specifically of the Areeb Center. And so when I was thinking of alternative financing, this is what came to my mind. Fast forward 2.5 years, we're here now with a bundle package of schools that could be given in contract to a corporation, which is very different than what I had in mind when we were looking or thinking about alternative financing. And so what's before us right now is a resolution to essentially affirm a stance of being for the six or seven schools that have been presented. My issue here is that we have not been given a financial analysis of what this looks like. Specifically, we've been given, during our board retreat, we had a summary of what that looks like. That was back in April, but we haven't seen the specific financials behind that. Additionally, we haven't been, I think, fully made aware of all of the risks as is involved with P3. I have reached out as a result of seeing the op-ed article in the Washington Post around concerns with P3. I've reached out to some different organizations to ask for their input and insight when it comes to P3, and some researchers have told me about situations like in Alberta, Canada, where they were promised over $245 million worth of savings and individual school districts ended up paying more in their P3 efforts, and they actually decided to stop doing alternative financing. And so these are things that are concerning to me because this is a resolution, and it's essentially what it inherently does is affirm our stance on an issue. And I really want to know that this process can work, but I'm not prepared to take a stance on something where we don't have a clear financial analysis and where we haven't been actively warned of the risks involved. So I think the better way to do this, and I have a counterproposal, instead of taking a stance and passing this type of a resolution, I think we should get more involved in the process. And it's for that reason that I'd like to offer a substitute motion that essentially, excuse me for one second, I'm trying to pull it up. A substitute motion that essentially gets us a bit more involved in the process. And that substitute motion is to have administration come to us with what they have planned to release as an RFP, essentially telling us what is the scope of the project before it goes live and out to bidders. I think in this way we can better understand what it is that our system is looking at. We can provide insight on what we believe needs to be in the process, what needs to be in our contract proposal. And I think in this way I'd feel much more comfortable in ensuring that we are being the responsible advocates that we need to be on this board, knowing that we're going into a process that's unprecedented, that's unchartered. So yes, that's my substitute motion. Would you like me to repeat it?
No, I think we have it. I don't hear a second for it.
Okay.
Okay, the substitute is on the floor. Seeing no, Mr. Burrows.
You know, this is my first time hearing about the substitute. Are you just essentially saying that you want to have input on the RFP before its release? Is that what you're saying?
I think the RFP should come before us for a vote before it goes out to be bid. Like, I think we need to have insight in that, what that looks like before it goes out.
So I believe that is the point of the resolution, because generally the board doesn't approve RFPs, and the resolution is supposed to be an opportunity for us to put into action or to inform the administration what we would like to see in RFP. For example, there were several things that I wanted in the RFP, and letter H and letter I are those things on page 3 that talks about minority business participation, not just over the general contract, but of each element of the contract. 30% on design, build, and to maintain, so that our minority and local businesses will benefit greatly. And so that's something that this resolution will dictate to the administration to include in the RFP. The other issue or thing that I know the chair worked hard on and I worked hard on to include with the administration is letter I, and that is to express to the companies that we want apprenticeships and scholarship endowments and them to build the capacity of our minority businesses. And so I see this resolution as a directive to the administration for what we want in the RFP. And so I don't know if that satisfies your concern or not, but I wanted to offer that. And I think now is the time to, like, do you have amendments or concerns that, I'm just trying to figure out a way to
Build the bridge, yeah. I appreciate that. I didn't
just a moment, Mr. Ahmed. Are you finished?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Seeing no other comments, Mr. Ahmed, you're recognized for 3 minutes.
Sure. I understand that, and I appreciate that. I didn't see this as a working document, and I think my concern, what I didn't mention before, is that in the summary of the analysis for JLL that JLL had done for us, there were two options, and the package of schools that are presented here is not in either of those two options. And so essentially, I don't know, even if we were to get a financial analysis of what was originally done, that would not compute to what is being presented here in terms of the schools that are being provided. And it just feels, and y'all know how strict I am on the numbers. If the public will also see in a couple of minutes when we're talking about CIP, But that is also of concern to me. I do appreciate now knowing that this is a document that you see that you had inputted specific things to direct administration. But I don't know that I still feel that there is a firm financial understanding of what we're getting into here.
So thank you. Mr. I always get the lights mixed up. I think it's Mr. Wallace. Mr. Valentine.
Mr. Valentine. Yeah. Just briefly, and it sort of speaks to my colleague, Mr. Burroughs, as it relates to the role of the board, as it relates to RFPs, and this does set a precedent for this board that I would not like to set and would not support, because it does open the door for us to inject ourselves into something that we don't normally do, and the board was not set up to do, and we'll set up for conversations around other board members asking for similar input in RFP moving forward on a myriad of things that relate to the school system, and it may not be anybody on this board, but could also set up some conflicts of interest, and so I'm mindful of that, and that is why I'm not supporting.
Colleagues, the vote is on the substitute. Mr. Burroughs, you want to say something? Okay, please.
I would also say that I'm not sure what your communication has been with the administration, but there is a financial document associated with this that outlines that I think would explain what you're looking for that's not included in the resolution.
Yeah, I had asked for the value for money analysis, and I got the summary that was presented to us by the board. But even still, like, all, if there is a document out there, that's something that should be provided to all of us before resolutions being presented on an issue. I mean, this is a package, right? Where is the package?
Ms. Ahmed, I recognize you. Mr. Burroughs, are you finished?
I just wanted to make a note that information was sent today at 5 o'clock. You sent the questions yesterday, and we responded today.
Okay. Mr. Burroughs, is that it? Okay, thank you. Ms. Tate, please call the roll.
Ms. Ahmed.
Aye.
Ms. Boozer Struther.
No.
Mr. Burroughs.
No.
Ms. Eubanks. Mr. Montero.
No.
Mr. Murray.
No.
Mr. Omolola. Oh, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
No.
I think you can, okay.
Ms. Queen. Ms. Shepherd.
No.
Mr. Thomas.
No.
Mr. Valentine. Mr. Wallace.
No.
Ms. Williams.
No.
Dr. Thornton.
No. We'll go back now to the main motion, Mr. Wallace. Mr. Wallace, main motion, you have any comments?
I was trying to be fair. No problem. Just a small correction on page 3, item I. Just want to fix that acronym. There's one too many letters in our PGCPS acronym. That's a friendly amendment there. And then my comment is on the community engagement of the schools that will be positively impacted. I know in the resolution it says that feasibility studies are not required, but is there any possibility of at least engagement of the community? I know that you won't have to do a planning committee like we've done at other schools, and I'm sitting on two of them now, but could we at least engage and let them know that, you know, you're about to have shovels in the ground?
Yeah, there'll be two opportunities. One will be governed by PGCPS, so we'll do our own community engagement, and then separately, as it relates to whatever firm is selected, they'll do their round. So for the next 3 years or so, we're going to be yelling from the mountaintops and getting people engaged as to what type of school they're looking for, and updates on the process itself along the way.
Thank you very much. I yield back.
Thank you. Mr. Burroughs.
Dr. Golson, I have a point of information. For the Southern Area Middle School, for the final board action summary, I would like it to include the two schools, my name.
Yeah, so that will be corrected on the final document, and just for the public's knowledge, the Southern Area Middle School will be a K-8 that combines Potomac Landing and Isaac Ordain.
Thank you. Also, colleagues, you know, growing up in this county, I hear all the time at the Civic Association meetings how the politicians, whenever there's a huge influx of money, you know, it's all these promises that it will benefit the community, and it rarely does. And so it was important, I know, to me, to Dr. Thornton, to Dr. Golson, and to each of you, that we included language in here that I believe will help benefit our county as a whole. And as I mentioned before, letter H, the minority business and local business requirement of 30%. I think it makes a very big difference that this 30% will not just be over on the overall contract, but will be on every element of the contract, including the maintenance portion once it's turned over to us and the building is open, which means that local minority businesses will benefit from this agreement for years, several years. And so I want to thank the administration for including that language. And thank you, Mr. Matlock and Mr. Stanton, for your work on that, because that distinction will mean a world of difference to our local minority businesses in our county. That's something that this board should be proud of. Secondly, I'd like to thank Dr. Thornton and also Dr. Golson again for letter I, and that is allowing these major corporations to compete to lay out the best community investment agreement that they can before this board and before the administration. We are interested in seeing apprenticeships. We're interested in seeing scholarship endowments to Bowie State University or, you know, wherever. We're interested in seeing these large corporations building the capacity of minority businesses and whatever else they come up with. But I think I'm very proud that that's included. I would also encourage these very large companies to partner with our local labor unions, because it's so important that we pay our workers, our people who live in our county, a prevailing wage and provide health care and protections, and unions do that. And so I believe those three things will make a big difference for the workforce in the county.
Thank you, colleague. Ms. Williams, and then Ms. Queen, and then Ms. Ahmed.
First, I'd like to congratulate the Capital Programs Department for getting us this far. This has been a big undertaking. Many, many meetings, many discussions with everyone across the board, so it's a big undertaking. The old saying that when you repeat the same thing over and over again, expecting different results, is insanity. This public-private partnership allows us to do something differently. The success and failure rate of all ways of doing construction, it's about the same across the board. There's success in the traditional way, there's the success and failures in design build, and there are success and failures in the public-private partnership arena. There are success and failures across the board. When I got on the board in 2014, and we had a consultant come in and talk about closing 29 schools and opening 7, in my mind, that was insane. There is no way that we could absorb 29 schools worth of students in 7. And then when we looked at where those schools are going to be, the vast difference between the North and the South, it was impossible. So in discussions with the Capital Programs Office, we discussed many ways to look at how to deliver new schools quicker, because the traditional way took 10 years from concept to opening doors. This public-private partnership that we call ACF is going to open our schools much quicker and give us an efficient and effective way to run and manage our schools. In order to deliver services to 209 schools and still build new schools while we're doing that, we would have to be a large construction company. We are not in the business of building. We're in the business of education. So this is going to allow us to put that matter, that work, where it belongs with the experts, and allow us to focus on delivering the best education system in the best buildings possible. So when we talk about the financing, whether or not it's elementary, middle, high, a mix of those. What we have is the availability payment of $30 million a year. That money, from my understanding, because I've been listening to the conversations and the presentations of our department, it's going to come from, partially come from, the maintenance that we would be using to maintain those old buildings. If we eliminate old buildings, that maintenance money is available for us to pay for someone else to handle our HVAC, our heating and cooling, our window issues, our all of those things. So let's do that. So as you all know, I am wholeheartedly in support of this ACF program moving forward. The way that we have been discussing for a year and a half plus with the work group. So I look forward to us making this a success. And yes, there have been some failures around the world, but the world is looking at us because we're taking an innovative approach and we've taken some thought into delivering this the best way possible. So I don't want to be insane and continue to do the things that we've been doing over the years. Let's look outside of the box, try something different, and definitely I will be holding you all accountable to meet the milestones that you have laid out in this program. Thank you.
Thank you, colleague. Ms. Queen and Ms. O'Madden, and then we should be able to vote. Ms. Queen.
Yes, I just want to thank you all for going outside the box and thinking about the P3, but I do agree a little bit with Ms. O'Madden. We do need to be conscious because it's almost like going out there and buying stock and depending on trying to see if this is going to work because it is something that hasn't been done by us. I think we need to be transparent because we are going to be spending taxpayers' money in the long run. So I hope that no matter how we go through this P3, that we be transparent when we do have issues, that we be open about it. We don't try to sweep things under the rug because, as my colleague Sonia just said, you have success and failures. Failures simply need the opportunity to begin again. And maybe we can do it more intelligent if we do make mistakes. But the thing is, we have to be transparent to our students, our parents, and our taxpayer. Also, success is not final. Failure is not fatal. It is the courage to continue. So we can continue to do it. I believe that P3 is a change that is needed. We have a lot of schools that are falling apart. We need new schools. So I definitely can accept the change of going through with the P3 because I think if we look at it, if we don't try something, then it to me is a waste for us not to do anything. So going through with the P3, I believe that it's something that we do need to do, but in doing it, we have to be transparent to the people we are accountable to when it comes to their tax dollars. Thank you.
Thank you. And Ms. Ahmed.
Yes, I just wanted to a couple of data requests. Dr. Goldson, I looked through my email. I didn't receive the financial analysis so I would appreciate if you could resend that. And then the other thing is, I understand that there's been a lot of work done from the work group, but not all of that information has been presented to this board. So my request is that all the documents that have been presented to the work group to be presented to this board so that we can be just as up to date as Ms. Williams is.
Thank you. Colleagues, the vote is on 6-3. Please call the roll.
Ms. Ahmed?
I'll abstain.
Ms. Boozer Struther?
Yes.
Mr. Burroughs? Ms. Eubanks? Mr. Montero?
Yes.
Mr. Murray?
Aye.
Ms. Queen?
Yes.
Ms. Shepherd?
Yes.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Mr. Valentine?
Aye.
Mr. Wallace?
Aye.
Ms. Williams?
Yes.
And Dr. Thornton.
Aye. Thank you. The motion carries. Thank you, colleagues. I was waiting on Mr. Burroughs' vote, so it was very important. Okay, that's Dr. Goldson, we'll now move to the unfinished business 7-1 and 7-2, if you'll introduce those.
Yes, item 7.1 and 7.2 requires board approval of the FY 2020 Comprehensive Maintenance Plan and the Capital Improvement Program for fiscal years 2021 through 2026.
A motion is in order regarding these two, and we'll pull them for discussion.
Can we separate them, please?
Yes. Motion is in order regarding 7-1.
Move approval.
It's probably moved and seconded that we approve 7-1. Ms. Samet.
Yes, Dr. Goldson, at the last board meeting, I'd requested that the SMART goals and objectives be included in the plan for maintenance, and you'd indicated that it'd be added as an addendum, but I see it under the follow-up item instead. So is that, was that instead of in the actual document as an addendum, so is that an oversight? Can that be rectified?
You want it in the, where do you want it?
Like in the document as an addendum, as you had mentioned.
Fine.
That's fine. We can, we can move it from the follow-up items to the actual document.
Perfect. Thank you. That's all.
Thank you, Ms. Samet. Mr. Wallace.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Colleagues, as the chair of the board's committee on operations, fiscal affairs, and the budget, I would be remiss if I didn't thank my colleagues for a very robust conversation. We had all members of the committee present, in person or virtually, to discuss both item 7.1 and 7.2. In regards to 7.1, the comprehensive maintenance plan, there was a lot of discussion around our CTE apprenticeship program and making sure that we as a board are supporting our administration as best as possible to fix a lot of the work orders that are placed, particularly around painting. I know Ms. Queen had a lot, and I'll let her share her comments about that, as well as landscaping. Colleagues, I'm a stickler for what I like to call our physical marketing. We can have the best academic programs. We saw tonight we're doing tremendous gains in the classroom for a lot of our students, and that matters. But we have to start looking at our buildings as recruitment tools. And for a lot of our parents that are public school advocates, but also want to make sure that their child is going to a well-maintained facility. And quite honestly, they choose private school because of that alone. I am prepared, and I have been drafting a resolution that would create a focus work group around our comprehensive maintenance plan and making sure that we are efficient and effective with our board funds and finding ways that we can be even more supportive of our administration to ease the concerns of our community around how their school system buildings look. I will present that at our next committee meeting, and hopefully the committee will pass it to the full board and we can look at that issue. But I did want to share that the committee did unanimously support the current comprehensive maintenance plan with the hope of continuing work forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you. I want to thank you as chair of the committee and members of the committee for the work that you all did on this issue. And I'll recognize Ms. Williams and Ms. Queen, and we should be able to vote. Ms. Williams.
A quick question. In the comprehensive maintenance plan, there is a checklist of items that happen daily, weekly, monthly. Is there a way that we could see that the results on an annual basis of what is found in each of the schools? In my experience, information that is tracked that way, we're able to begin to predict the buildings that are going to present trouble in the future. I would just like to be able to have access or some information or data share or something on that type of thing.
Yes, and currently that's captured on paper, but we're moving to our preventive maintenance program to put that in there, so we will, I'm not sure how soon that will happen, but that's exactly what we want to do, be able to create data, usable data that we can track. Right now, it's done on Excel spreadsheets, and our coordinators track it individually, but we're trying to do just that, and when we do, we can provide it to you.
Okay, great. Yeah. So since you don't have it, and I know it's going to take a minute to produce something like that, as you're thinking about it, if I think that it should become a part of our regular reporting, maybe just once a year or something, just so we can be aware, district by district, where we may have issues, especially as we move through the cycle one, cycle two, cycle three. My additional question is, how are we doing on the school dudes tracking of capital maintenance requests in the schools?
We're doing well. As you know, we track how long it takes us to do a work order. Our goal is to be at 105 days. We're currently at 107. This year we were able to do 10% more work orders, 9.1% more work orders than we did last year. So we're starting to produce data that we can use to drive our workforce. And we started an initial program that puts focuses on time periods, like in 6 months chunks, so we can create a sense of urgency to get those older work orders done. And we've been able to take out 6 month chunks of the older work orders and focus on those and have our workforce focus on those older work orders and get those done. Because what happens is we tend to, over the summer, this year we had the three schools we had to move, so we shift around and we start to do things and we forget about those old work orders. So we're focusing back to our oldest work orders and trying to push everything forward to get us caught up.
And I know our principals will appreciate that, looking at those older work orders. Is there a way to keep us in the loop, or, well, let me rephrase that. Is there a way to go back and check the quality control of the work that was completed? Do
yes,
you
there
have
is.
A process for that?
We have a process. We've 2 years ago, we had minimal middle management. There was someone running the shop and then most of the mechanics. We've established a greater middle management crew that is doing just that. And what we're doing is we're establishing a certain percentage of the work orders that are going to be assigned to them to go check. So it will be random by employees, so we make sure we get that across the board. Because that was one of my concerns, was we were doing the work, but we weren't doing a very good job of it. And I noticed that, and I want our supervisors out there checking behind our workforce.
Right. So I just think that it's important that we do a follow-up check on those items that are done to make sure that the principal or whoever requested it is satisfied with the outcome.
Sure. And we reorganized our office last year. I have two more coordinators starting in about a month, which will give me three maintenance coordinators focused strictly on maintenance, and they will be the conduit between myself and the principal. So that will give each coordinator roughly 60 schools, so we can have a more personal relationship, because the whole process revolves around supporting the principals in the educational process.
Thank you. And just my last final comment is, this is the reason why P3 is so important, is that maintenance piece. Some of those things you guys are still going to handle, the smaller things, but those larger things that come up, having someone else who can call, you can call and hold responsible, will help us to reduce that lag time between the request and the completion. So thank you for your work.
Thank you, Ms. Williams. Ms. Queen, Ms. Shepherd, and Mr. Omololo.
First of all, I want to publicly say thank you. I've been through a couple of my schools this year, and I know when I first started, one of the things is I said I walked through the schools, and I said it, they smell like piss. Well, I've been walking through the schools, and I don't smell that smell anymore, but I still need a little bit more Pine Sol for Breeze or something in them schools. But I just ask you to keep doing what you guys are doing, but work on, I would like to see every floor like mop and glow shining and every school smelling a little bit better, so I ask that you continue to work on that. And I also want to comment on what my colleague said when we talked about the CTE programs, because yesterday I attended the educational workforce at the county council that council member Harrison chaired, and they were talking about the same thing. They had someone from another school district, I can't remember, and they brought them in and they talked about the program they had, and they talked about how they had it at every school, and it was opened up that every child, whoever wanted, was able to attend these programs. And even Councilman Harrison talked about when he walked through the school, and he suggested I go see it, it sounds so good, I'm just late. He said you can actually tell who was a plumber, who was a nurse, who was going to be a scientist, because the school was set up that way. And I know our county council is working hard to get Prince George's County Public Schools the same way we are thinking. And it was fun. And to me, it was like we're thinking on the same level, because we were thinking in our committee the same thing, how we can make sure that we have the trades that our students succeed, even in helping you with the maintenance trades, you know, people doing the painting, people doing the landscaping. So I think as we continue to grow and we realize that it's up to us to make sure our kids succeed, but also in that same part of succeeding is use them within our school system. So again, I thank you for all you're doing.
Thank you.
I can tell you our apprentice program has really put a spring in the step of our workforce. A lot of our older, more experienced employees this summer really enjoyed coming to work and came in early, stayed late to work with those kids, and it's been a phenomenal success.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Ms. Shepherd.
So I just want to get more clarity in your comment that you just stated about when issues happen during the summer, you have to move schools and things get more busy, you forget about older orders that you have. So what is the process that you have in order for you to ensure that you don't forget about those orders? Because as a simple as a bathroom being clogged, when you don't, you know, pay attention to that, that will lead to a major issue of pipes being or other, you know, major issues. So what is the process that you are going to continue to do to make sure that you don't forget about those orders?
Right, and what I was speaking of is we had a plan coming into the summer to we were going to move Central High School into Forestville. The other two moves were not planned. They were, that was something that happened over the summer. So Dr. Golson made it perfectly clear those kids were not going to be affected by these moves. So I had to readjust our workforce over the summer to make that happen. And that was our goal for the summer, to get those two, get Forest Heights and get the TPA moved. Once we getting them moved, put everything that we had planned to do on this summer. So now our focus right now, starting September 15th, was to go back where we were starting at the beginning of the summer and start to push those work orders through. This was something that was unplanned. We typically have a plan for the summer to do just what I wanted to do, but because of the unforeseen circumstances, we had to change our plans.
Thank you, Ms. Shepherd. Ms. Boozer Strother.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Stefanelli, and a big thank you to you, Mr. Stanton, Dr. Goldson, for your responsiveness and working on issues and responding to emails. And what I really appreciated is you being open to PTA leaders, parent advocates in buildings, and particularly, as you know, I'm working with parents who are in the buildings that are in their end of life these last few years until the new buildings are built, which are very difficult and have problems daily. So thank you for allowing that collaborative relationship, because we know we want our principals focused on instruction, and if parents can help with this conversation around maintenance, that I think that's been working well. Unfortunately, as I go to back to school nights, I'm learning that I have some other buildings in my district that are in the, you know, at these end of life places, which have many more but don't have an advocate. So one thing I was thinking about, I appreciated what you just explained about how the process is going to work from this point forward. I would ask that if Dr. Goldson, if you could draft one of your letters to the school community and parents that focuses in on how maintenance is working and how this is progressing, because I think that would go a long way in the communication piece of when parents, teachers, and others are frustrated with this aspect of the school system, that if there could be one of those letters that we receive as parents that explain some broader aspects or you know, work that the school system is doing. I think that would help a lot in just continuing to you know, working all together to help message timelines and the realities that we're all working under. Okay. So, but thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Valentine, was your light?
Yes, sir. I was going to clarify, it was Ms. Queen, it was from Henrico County, Virginia, who presented yesterday. I just wanted to reiterate publicly something I shared with Dr. Cadet privately around the CTE program and sort of reframing the work around CTE and including the entrepreneurship track that I believe you all are including in the curriculum. The idea that people would go into fields like plumbing or carpentry solely to be a plumber and not look at it as a business owner, I think is short-sighted. I give the example that my barber drives a Tesla. And I would imagine he would not call himself a barber. He's an entrepreneur, he's a business owner. And he has to deal with scheduling, with inventory, with hiring, I mean, with everything that a business owner would have, but the service he is providing is barbering. Similarly with cosmetology, all the different things that we talk about, and when we present these to our students, do you want to be a plumber? obviously the first thing they're going to think about is someone coming in and working with their hands and not having all the opportunities that people who have other careers. But if you look at it and say, well, eventually you're going to have to hire 50 employees, you need 30 vans, you need marketing, you need staffing, you need payroll. Are you prepared to do that? It's a whole different proposition. And so when I spoke with Dr. Cadet, he mentioned that was an aspect of what you all were thinking about. So I would reiterate that publicly to you and to the staff, that is something we can really frame, both to our students, to our parents who are looking at this, and whether they want to put their children into these programs or whether they believe their children are headed for a future like other children if they're going to this field. I would just say many of those business owners make a lot more money than lawyers and doctors do, with a lot less of the insurance issues. So I would definitely reiterate that, and in any way we as a board can support how we present this to parents and students, but also to ensure that we are fully funding anything that it takes to really ensure that the entrepreneurship aspect and really getting behind the skill it takes to do the work, but to run a business, is shared with our students.
What we tried to do this summer is, in our HVAC and plumbing trade, was to try to let them experience what it was like to work in the office, the person that's helping design, to order the parts, to set the project up. So it's not a business, but it's what you have to do to run a business. So they're getting that office experience along with the hands-on experience in the field. We tried to keep them in big projects where they would learn things at not just going out and making a repair. There was a lot involved in the program, and having them work over the summer when we're doing our projects is a benefit to them.
And I'll just add one thing. With my home, we have a home insurance company called American Home Shield, and we brought in a plumber. I had a chance to speak with him and find out that he was a graduate of Suitland High School with my wife, and that was over 20 years ago. But what he learned at Suitland High School, he was still using it and had not had any post-secondary school education. But for the next 22 years, was able to sustain himself and his family off a skill he learned at Suitland High School 22 years prior. And we sat and we talked and talked about all the business he had from just a skill, had no college debt, which I envy, but was someone who could really do so. And so I was so proud to be able to have that conversation with him around a skill he learned 22 years prior at our public school that he's still using today. He may never make the Hall of Fame for our system, but he's a really strong representative of what we can do with our system. So I just wanted to say that.
Thank you, sir. College, the vote is on 7-1. Those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposing, no. The ayes have it. Motion regarding 7-2, please. It's been properly moved, and who seconded it? Second, that the board approves. Is there a discussion? Ms. Ahmed.
Yeah, so Mr. Matlock, I have a couple of questions. Before we get to this board back here, I was looking at Appendix E, and I was just wondering, how are the lists of projects there determined? Can you pause my time, please?
So, Appendix E.
It's all the HVAC and.
Exactly. So, that's a combination of consultation between the Department of Capital Programs and the Department of Building Services. We get together, we evaluate the facilities, and then once the facilities have been evaluated, projects based on urgency and need are then included into that process.
Okay.
There's also some points in here where there are some various, where we give a little variability for projects that we don't foresee.
Okay. I think when I was looking through that section, I added it up, and it was over $25 million worth of funds allocated for various schools or various sites, various buildings. And I'm just kind of uncomfortable with the thought that that's that much of uncommitted funds, because it feels that could then be moved at will wherever it's needed, and it won't remain in that category for that purpose. And so my question is, why can't those funds be committed to specific projects that we know exist?
Well, in most cases, they kind of are. The problem is a lot of them are small projects. They may, in our viewpoint, small projects, you know, 250, 500,000, various projects at various schools. we want to create some flexibility because, in fact, we do have some projects that come under budget and some that come over budget. And so we do sometimes realign monies in order to match the budget with the need.
Okay. And then behind me, I made a chart because I was looking at numbers. I was looking at the fiscal year 20 CIP. I was looking at the fiscal year 21 update that was given to us at the end of this, at the end of August, and then the one that's presented before the board today. And these are the bottom line numbers for the total cost of these projects. And I noted some variances between those different three different areas. My question is why are certain things going up? Why are certain things going down? With specific emphasis on this Cool Spring and Judith Hoyer, because it increased a little bit in the last update that you showed us from, you know, it's at 40, it was at 45, and now it's all the way to 72 million. And so just could you provide some insight on how these sure. different projects are moving? Thank you.
So specifically, you brought this to my attention earlier. Mm-hmm. And so I was consulting with my staff, and what I was reminded of is that there was a discussion about scope increase related to that. This is two schools, really, that we're trying to merge and to make one big academy, a lower and upper school. And originally, the plan was to do an addition and to upgrade one of the schools that are not currently classrooms, turn them into classrooms. What we decided, or what the staff decided, was that the other school needed upgrading too. Since we were there, it made sense to upgrade both schools since it was going to be an integrated program. And that's why there was an increase. It was basically the expanded scope.
Okay, and then for Cherokee Lane and International High School, those numbers went up a little bit from last year as well in terms of the total budget.
Yeah, and they probably will go down again. We're right now, there was a, both projects are unique. Cherokee Lane is primarily an off-site construction. By the nature of the project, it's a pilot program. We're trying to bring the project price under $30 million. Right now, though, we have design costs and some other things that are not part of the construction costs that have caused it to go up a little bit. We're dealing with that right now. And then the other one was
International
High School. That also was a very low budget that we originally came out with. It was under $25 million. But unfortunately, given the fact that we want to have a regulation soccer field for their championship soccer team, and because we want to have a regulation gym so that it functions like a high school instead of a glorified elementary school, the cost had to go up a little bit. And so that's reflective of that increase based upon the desire to give them a real high school.
Okay, and my time is about to get up. I wanted to ask the chair if it's okay if Mr. Matlock went through High Point, Adelphi, and Suitland quickly.
No, you can provide those to Ms. Ahmed, please.
Sure.
Provide that information to Ms. Ahmed and to the board. The response to that?
Yes.
Please do that. Colleagues, the vote is on 7-2. Call the roll, please.
Ms. Ahmed?
Aye.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
Aye.
Ms. Boozer Strother?
Yes.
Mr. Burroughs?
Abstain.
Ms. Eubanks? Mr. Montero?
Yes.
Mr. Murray?
Aye.
Ms. Queen?
Aye.
Ms. Shepherd?
Yes.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Mr. Valentine? Mr. Wallace?
Aye.
Ms. Williams?
Yes.
Dr. Thornton?
Aye.
Ayes have it.
Thank you very much. Mr. Burroughs, would you like to record your vote regarding the P3, the alternative financing?
Yes, on item 6.03, I vote yes.
Thank you, Mr. Burroughs. Colleagues, I'd like to have a motion to approve items taken in executive session.
So moved.
Items involving labor negotiations, legal matters, student appeals, personnel matters, internal audit, chief executive officer, administrative matters. It's been properly moved and seconded. Those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposing, no. The ayes have it. Motion to adjourn. It's properly moved and seconded. Those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposing, no. The ayes have it. Thank you, colleagues. And Dr. Golson, thank you.